Profesor Nizam, PLT Direktur Jenderal Pendidikan Tinggi Riset dan Teknologi Kementerian Pendidikan Kebudayaan Riset dan Teknologi, para panelis, Profesor Wening Udasmoro, Profesor Fakultas Ilmu Budaya Universitas Gajah Mada, Dr. Lidwina Inge Nur Cahyo, Lektor Kepala Fakultas Hukum Universitas Indonesia, Ms. Marie McCabrang, Affiliated Professor at Sciences Po Law School, a member of the Scientific Committee of the Presage Sciences Po OFCE Research and Academic Program on Gender Thinking, an appointed expert for France on gender equality for the EU Commission. Sylvain Dome, Network of France Victims Sciences Po. Ms. Purnasen, Visiting Professor, Child and Women Abuse Studies Unit, London Metropolitan University. Dewi Wulandari, Direktur Local Hope Helps Universitas Indonesia. Para tamu undangan, Ibu, Bapak, dan rekan-rekan sekalian. Sebelum mendengarkan paparan dari para pembicara, saya ingin menginformasikan bahwa kami menyediakan penerjemahan simultan dalam bahasa Inggris dan bahasa Indonesia. Untuk mendengarkan terjemahan, bagi pengguna komputer, silakan klik gambar bola dunia dengan tulisan Interpretation di kanan bawah layar. Bagi pengguna smartphone atau tablet, klik gambar tiga titik atau More di kanan bawah layar dan pilih Interpretation. Lalu pilih audio Anda, off untuk tanpa terjemahan, English untuk terjemahan dalam bahasa Inggris, bahasa Indonesia untuk terjemahan dalam bahasa Indonesia. Suara penerjemah akan terdengar bersama dengan suara pembicara dan Anda tidak akan perlu mengubah setelan ini sepanjang sesi. Pastikan mikrofon Anda senantiasa dalam keadaan mati atau mute untuk mengurangi gangguan pada penyelenggaraan sesi. The Zoom webinar session comes with simultaneous interpretation in English and Indonesian language. If you wish to listen to the translation, for computer users, click the globe icon labeled with interpretation at the bottom right corner of your screen. For smartphone or tablet users, click the three dots or more at the bottom right corner of your screen and choose interpretation. Then select audio off for without translation, English for translation into English, Bahasa Indonesia for translation into Indonesian. You will hear the interpreter's voice along with the speaker's voice, and there is no need to change the setting throughout the session. Be sure to mute your microphone while you are not speaking to minimize disruption to the session. Kami informasikan juga selama acara berlangsung, apabila ada yang ingin ditanggapi atau ingin bertanya, bisa terlebih dahulu mengisi di kolom chat. Nanti panitia akan mengumpulkan seluruh pertanyaan yang kemudian akan dilontarkan kepada moderator di sesi tanya-jawab. Tanpa menunggu lebih lama, saya ingin mempersilahkan Bapak Stéphane Dovert, Konselor Kerjasama Kedutaan Besar Perancis untuk Indonesia dan Direktur IVI Indonesia untuk membuka acara sore ini.
Terima kasih Bu Tifa, terima kasih sama MC, selamat malam sama semua peserta, teman-teman, dosen-dosen, peneliti, dan semua orang yang peduli sama kekerasan berbasis gender di universitas. This year saya akan pakai bahasa Inggris tetapi tidak apa-apa ada terjemahan di dalam semua bahasa. Ya. This year is an anniversary. We are celebrating the 30th edition of the 16 days campaign against gender-based violence. I am not sure if we can be happy of having some such a long story of advocacy because it means that maybe we don't move as well ahead as fast as we would love to. I hope that one of those days we will realize that no, we do not need to have this kind of seminar anymore. We are of course very glad to collaborate with UN Women as usual on this campaign and on this event. This year we choose to focus our campaign on young women and girls below the age of 25 as they are more prone to be the victims of gender-based violence. This brought us to address today the very important topic of violence in universities, because we tend to assume that universities are the smartest and the best, in a way, the well and best educated people. But we have to soon realize that even if maybe in reality, we face a lot of challenge that seems to be very barbarian and not suitable for what we call educated people. Violence in universities is a terrible worldwide phenomenon. I heard in the small film that 1 in 3 women in Indonesia have experienced kind of violence during their life. And 1 in 3 is very, very, is definitely too much. But according to Ken Dickwood, just to get back to our subject, very subject, violence in universities, 77% of lecturers claimed that there were sexual assault cases on campus. In France, throughout the past few years, many scandals were revealed in French university and prestigious, what we are very proud of, grandes écoles like Sciences Po, Centrale Supélec, where it was revealed that victims were often left to themselves. And I'm very glad that we have somebody from Sciences Po where we will try to give us a feedback on the experience. Until very recently, many victims, it's even worse, until very recently, many victims of abuse were not taken seriously, and some perpetrators never punished, while victims are sometimes pointed with fingers. To be frank, normally I'm a very smiley person, but to be frank, today this subject makes me flow in a terrible rage. I want to tell you why. I'm as head of cooperation for French Embassy, I try to face with the Indonesian government plenty of very complicated challenges. Of course, I would like to mention COVID. For instance, COVID, it's very difficult to balance the reaction you have to have facing such a pandemic. Do we have to keep everybody at home? Means that we stop any activities and some people will lose their capacity of earning what they need. And we know that the number of people falling under the line of poverty is raising. Or do we have to allow everybody to work to try to live their life, taking the risk of people dying? So it's very balanced, and nobody can say, oh yes, I'm very sure I have a solution. The same for global warming. We have to change of model in terms of electricity. We have to move to renewables, but renewables are more challenging in a way for many reasons, including the cost. And so it's very challenging. Do we have to move very fast, or do we have to try to mix up a little bit? That's really challenging, and nobody can say what is a great solution. Nobody can pretend, yes, I know. Same thing for biodiversity. We know that we lose biodiversity at a pace that is just terrible. But facing this issue is difficult because land is very much at stake. People like to have plantations. For instance, palm oil is a challenge for Indonesia because plenty of people rely on palm oil, and it's a very great resource for Indonesia, and it's a need for population to feed. But there is a challenge with forest. And this is difficult. This is difficult. You don't have a clear solution. Rather, for gender-based violence, there is one very clear and simple solution. Tolerance zero for young men who pretend to be part of humankind, but who act worse than beasts. So let's be very clear, here we have a solution. Don't do it. There is no anything to balance with. It's not, it's tricky, it's difficult. No, let's say stop. No excuse for lack of respect. No excuse to take profit of its strengths against persons that are weaker than you. No excuse to brutalize. No excuse to traumatize. No cultural excuses. No religious excuses, no background kind of life experience excuses, no excuses at all, no parental full kindness as well. You don't have to tolerate. Nobody has to tolerate. Just firm condemnation for everyone. Sanction applied by all components of society. Blaming. Just clear report to police. No ambiguous discussions. No male indulgence at all. Just simply stop it. So it seems to me clear, it seems to be simple, but as we know, as any social challenges we face, we have to find the way. But finding the way when you don't have something to counterbalance seems to me simpler. Similarly, I want to tell you how I want to recognize, first of all, the commitment of Minister Nadine Makarim in fighting against gender-based violence in universities through new measures. It seems to me clear, important, and nothing too bad to say about it. We just have to move on. Similarly, in France, the Minister of Higher Education, Mrs. Frédéric Vidal, has recently announced a 7 million euro, 5 years plan to go further in this direction. Our two countries are together in this fight and can clear a lot from each other, can learn a lot from each other, as it's a necessity to share the best practices and go ahead hand in hand. The solution will come from the dedication of all members of the university world. I want to thank the students who are here today, as their voice has not been heard louder than ever. We have to act together here and now. It's a price to deserve our pride to be part of humankind. If we want to consider ourselves as part of humankind, just stop the barbarian practices against women in university and elsewhere. Finally, I want to thank Professor today as a first contact and authorities figures to the students who will present their experience and solutions. So I think you have understood with my kind of upset attitude and behaviors that it's not business as usual. I am quite accustomed of speaking, of delivering speech, to be frank, so twice a day maybe. But this one is very special. I just want us to be decisive and not to be chit-chatting as we always do by saying, so we say what we need to say and then we get back to business as usual. Whatever will be said, and I know all the speakers and their commitment, all what will be said have to be heard and taken into account for behaviors, not only to agree or disagree, but just to act accordingly. We have solutions. The panelists have plenty of solutions to offer. Then we just have to follow their path. Have a fruitful discussion. Thank you very much.
Terima kasih Bapak Stefan Dovert atas sambutannya. Selanjutnya saya persilahkan Ibu Dwi Faiz selaku Kepala Program UN Women Indonesia untuk memberikan kata pembuka.
Terima kasih. Saya tidak tahu lagi bagaimana harus memberikan kata pembuka kalau Bapak Stefan Dovert sudah memberikan sambutan yang begitu berapi-api, dan saya rasa kita semua bertepuk tangan dalam hati ya kalau kita tidak bisa bertepuk tangan secara langsung. Mungkin ruangan ini sudah sangat gemuruh dengan tepuk tangan untuk semangatnya yang luar biasa. Terima kasih Pak Stefan. Selamat sore, saya sampaikan kepada Prof. Nizam, Direktur Jenderal Pendidikan Tinggi dari Kementerian Pendidikan dan Kebudayaan Republik Indonesia, Bapak Stefan Dovert, sekutu kita yang paling bisa diandalkan untuk isu kekerasan dari French Embassy, dari Direktur IFI, Ibu Philomene Robin, Attaché for University Cooperation, French Embassy, para panelis, Profesor Civitas Akademika, rekan-rekan mahasiswa yang hadir pada sore hari ini. Pertama, sekali lagi saya berikan apresiasi kepada IFI dan kebudayaan Prancis di Indonesia atas kerjasama yang terjalin sejak tahun 2017. komitmen dalam mempromosikan kesetaraan gender dan penghapusan kekerasan terhadap perempuan dan anak perempuan di Indonesia tidak akan mungkin bisa dilakukan sendirian, dan kami sangat senang kita mempunyai sekutu yang sangat kuat. Ya. Kita sudah mengetahui seperti apa besarnya dampak kekerasan terhadap perempuan. Dan sejak kemarin, kita memulai kampanye Hari Anti Kekerasan Terhadap Perempuan selama 16 hari. Kampanye global yang harusnya meningkatkan perhatian mengenai situasi kekerasan terhadap perempuan dan juga memobilisasi dukungan terhadap penyintas. Selama 16 hari, dunia akan memberikan perhatian terhadap kemajuan yang sudah dicapai, apa saja yang masih ditingkatkan, perlu ditingkatkan. Dan yang paling utama adalah bagaimana kita semua bergerak bersama untuk mencegah kekerasan. Kita yakin bahwa sebenarnya harusnya tidak ada 16 hari, harusnya 365 hari. Saya setuju sekali dengan apa yang tadi disebut oleh Pak Stefan. Kita harus memobilisasi gerakan selama 365 hari setahun. 16 hari tidak cukup. Kita juga melihat bahwa dari sejak beberapa waktu yang lalu gaung mengenai kekerasan berbasis gender di kampus ini semakin keras terdengar, terutama dengan adanya peraturan Menteri Pendidikan. Dan kita tidak punya pilihan lain, juga ikut untuk bergerak dan bersuara lebih keras lagi. Untuk itu terima kasih untuk semua yang hadir dan yang ingin untuk suara para penyintas terdengar lebih keras, para mitra pemahaman, pemerintah, organisasi, akademisi, media, individu untuk bekerjasama membuat perubahan. Ibu, Bapak, teman-teman sekalian, seperti yang sudah disebutkan tadi di awal, sudah 3 dekade kita melakukan kampanye 16 hari anti kekerasan. Sayangnya selama 30 tahun kita masih harus diingatkan bahwa 1 dari 3 perempuan masih mengalami kekerasan fisik atau seksual setidaknya sekali dalam hidupnya. Momen ini juga harusnya menjadi bentuk refleksi bahwa di banyak kasus, penyintas masih sulit untuk mendapatkan keadilan, sedang pelaku bebas dari hukuman. Ketika kami merencanakan kegiatan webinar ini dengan Institut Prancis Indonesia, kami tidak menyangka bahwa peraturan Menteri Pendidikan sedang digodok dan kemudian dikeluarkan. Tentunya kami bergembira bahwa hari ini juga bergabung bersama kita perwakilan dari Kementerian Pendidikan. Saya juga gembira bahwa hari ini kita bisa bertemu dengan mahasiswa dan akademisi yang seiring sejalan dengan komitmen tersebut. Kami mengharapkan bahwa webinar ini penting dan kontekstual seiring dengan meningkatnya perhatian terhadap isu ini. Kami yakin bahwa pendidikan memiliki peran penting dan transformatif dalam menumbuhkan nilai-nilai kesetaraan, kesetaraan gender, keragaman, dan non-kekerasan. Walaupun sudah lama sekali, saya ingin mengaku bahwa baru kemarin gitu saya lulus dari kampus ya, tapi saya harus akui, saya harus jujur bahwa itu sudah lama sekali. Saya sangat lekat dalam ingatan saya betapa menyenangkannya hari-hari belajar di universitas. Dan yang paling melekat adalah pembelajaran itu tidak hanya di ruang-ruang kelas, tapi juga di ruang interaksi dengan mahasiswa, dengan sivitas akademisi yang lain. Tidak berlebihan kalau saya bilang, masa di perguruan tinggi itu sebenarnya adalah transisi menuju kedewasaan berpikir dan bernalar. Jadi, saya tidak bisa membayangkan apabila kampus yang seharusnya memberikan ruang belajar menjadi ruang pembiaran bagi kepentingan dan hak mahasiswa perempuan. Menurut data dari Komnas Perempuan, di sepanjang tahun 2015 sampai 2020, keseluruhan pengaduan di lembaga pendidikan, 27% aduan kasus kekerasan seksual terjadi di perguruan tinggi. Survei dari Mendikbudristek pada tahun 2019 juga memaparkan bahwa kampus berada di urutan ketiga lokasi terjadinya tindak kekerasan seksual, sebanyak 15% setelah jalanan dan transportasi umum. Kita seperti tidak lupa ceritanya Agni, satu penyintas di tahun 2019, bagaimana kisahnya membuka diskusi dan menjadi sebuah perlawanan terhadap segala bentuk kekerasan terhadap perempuan, khususnya di lingkungan universitas. Kisah Agni, kemudian kita movement yang namanya pakai tagar kita Agni, menunjukkan bahwa pelaporan kasus kekerasan sebenarnya bukan pencemaran nama baik, tapi kesempatan bagi dunia perguruan tinggi untuk menjadi lebih baik. Kita juga harus sadar bahwa masih banyak lagi cerita perempuan yang belum terekspos, belum mendapat respon, dan juga kita perlu lagi-lagi menghentikan budaya yang menormalisasi kekerasan, membungkam korban, membuat viktimisasi, serta memastikan bahwa korban mendapatkan layanan dan ada kebijakan dan sistem hukum yang dapat melindungi dan mendukung korban dalam mencari keadilan. Dikeluarkannya Permendikbudristek nomor 30 tahun 2021 tentang pencegahan dan penanganan kekerasan seksual di perguruan tinggi menjadi langkah progresif yang patut diapresiasi. Juga yang dapat mengisi kekosongan akan payung hukum yang lebih komprehensif. Kita sedang menanti dengan harap-harap cemas bagaimana undang-undang penghentian kekerasan seksual bisa dikeluarkan sesegera mungkin. Sore ini kita juga akan mendengar bagaimana beberapa kampus sebenarnya telah memulai langkah-langkah progresif ini. Ibu-ibu, bapak, dan rekan-rekan semua, saya meyakini bahwa di setiap tantangan akan muncul peluang yang mengacu kepada perubahan. Seperti hari ini, saya sangat menantikan untuk mendengarkan aspirasi mahasiswa akan kampus yang aman, berdiskusi dengan para akademisi mengenai penanggulangan kekerasan, serta belajar dari perwakilan universitas di Indonesia tentang bagaimana mereka merespon situasi dan menemukan solusi. Kami percaya diskusi hari ini akan berkontribusi pada upaya lanjutan untuk masa depan yang lebih cerah, yang lebih bebas dari kekerasan. Selamat berdiskusi. Saya, kami, UN Women, siap bergerak bersama civitas akademika di Indonesia untuk melawan kekerasan terhadap perempuan. Terima kasih. Saya kembalikan kepada MC.
Terima kasih, Ibu Dwi Faiz. Sebelum masuk kepada acara inti, kami ingin mengajak para narasumber, tamu undangan, dan hadirin sekalian untuk berfoto bersama. Untuk itu, bagi yang berkenan, mohon membuka kamera untuk diambil gambarnya oleh panitia. Saya akan memberikan hitungan 1-3 ya. Saya sambil tunggu dulu teman-teman, ada beberapa halaman ya di layar yang saya lihat di sini. Oke, yang halaman pertama sepertinya sudah ready. Saya hitung ya. 1, 2, 3. Oke, kita pindah ke halaman kedua. Saya nggak tahu nih teman-teman ada di halaman keberapa, jadi siap-siap aja ya. 1, 2, 3. Oke, ada berapa lagi nih panitia? Satu lagi? Satu lagi kita coba ya. 1, 2, 3. Oke, semoga sudah masuk semua panitia. Oke, terima kasih rekan-rekan sekalian. Jika ingin menutup kameranya kembali, dipersilahkan. Selanjutnya, kita memasuki acara inti diskusi virtual melawan kekerasan berbasis gender di universitas. Ibu, bapak, dan rekan-rekan sekalian, seperti yang tadi sudah disebutkan oleh Bapak Stevang dan juga Ibu Dwi Faiz, ya, perempuan masih mencemaskan dan mengalami berbagai bentuk kekerasan, seperti pelecehan dan kekerasan seksual, termasuk di lingkungan perguruan tinggi. Dan seperti diketahui bersama, Oktober lalu, Kementerian Pendidikan, Kebudayaan, Riset, dan Teknologi menerbitkan Permendikbudristek nomor 30 tahun 2021 tentang pencegahan dan penanganan kekerasan seksual di lingkungan perguruan tinggi. Kebijakan ini menjadi langkah awal yang penting dalam upaya penghapusan kekerasan seksual di kampus. Pada sore hari ini, kita akan mendengarkan dan berdiskusi dengan para pembicara untuk mengetahui apa saja yang sudah dilakukan dalam merespon kekerasan seksual di kampus, serta bertukar pengetahuan dan praktik baik dalam upaya pencegahan kekerasan. Namun sebelumnya, mari kita simak video dari teman-teman mahasiswa mengenai apa saja yang masih menjadi tantangan dan apa harapan mereka tentang pencegahan dan penanganan kekerasan seksual di kampus.
Halo, nama saya Syeda Delia. Saya seorang mahasiswa berumur 20 tahun.
Nama saya Novianti Mai.
Nama saya Zahra.
Nama saya Veronica Yupangestika.
Nama saya Esther Warikar.
Menurut saya, kampus yang aman adalah kampus yang tidak membuat mahasiswanya merasa takut, ragu, ataupun terancam untuk mengekspresikan dirinya sendiri.
Kampus yang aman adalah kampus yang memiliki mekanisme pelaporan yang mudah, memiliki krisis center yang berperspektif korban, dan bebas dari segala jenis kekerasan seksual.
Salah satu tantangan terbesar adalah masih langgengnya budaya patriarki, termasuk di dalamnya rape culture.
Oleh sebab itu, banyak korban kekerasan di kampus yang takut dan tidak berani untuk speak up.
Yang masih menjadi tantangan ialah kurangnya pengetahuan terkait isu kekerasan seksual di lingkungan kampus. Karena belum semua mahasiswa tahu tindakan-tindakan mana saja yang ternyata sudah masuk dalam kategori kekerasan seksual, dan justru menormalisasikan hal tersebut.
Harus adanya kesadaran diri pada setiap warga kampus untuk memberikan ruang aman, perlindungan, dan dukungan kepada korban kekerasan yang ada di kampus.
Saya berharap ada peraturan penanganan kekerasan seksual, apalagi sekarang sudah didukung dengan adanya Permendikbudristek nomor 30 tahun 2021. Harapannya dapat segera diimplementasikan amanat peraturan menteri tersebut demi terciptanya ruang aman bagi seluruh aktivitas akademika.
Selanjutnya, kampus harus melakukan pengarusutamaan pendidikan gender yang memuat kurikulum mengenai pencegahan kekerasan seksual. Kampus juga harus selalu hadir untuk korban dengan memberikan dukungan serta layanan yang mendukung pemulihan serta pencapaian keadilan bagi korban.
Yuk kita mulai perbanyak berdiskusi dan mengeluarkan aspirasi mengenai pentingnya menciptakan kampus yang bebas dari kekerasan.
Ya, tentunya harapan dari rekan-rekan mahasiswa barusan juga merupakan harapan kita semua. Ibu Bapak dan rekan-rekan sekalian, pada webinar ini telah hadir para pembicara yang berasal dari berbagai universitas, baik di Indonesia maupun dari Prancis. Perwakilan dari Hope Helps Universitas Indonesia dan juga moderator kita yang juga seorang pengajar dan banyak terlibat dalam diskusi terkait isu kekerasan terhadap perempuan dan kesetaraan gender. Langsung saja kami undang pembicara pertama kita, Profesor Wening Udasmoro. Profesor Wening Udasmoro adalah profesor bidang sastra dari Universitas Gadjah Mada. Beliau memperoleh gelar doktor dalam studi gender dari Universitas Jenewa, Swiss pada tahun 2005. Saat ini, beliau masih aktif dalam penelitian di bidang gender melalui jurnalnya berjudul The Transformation of Social Imaginary on Women's Sexuality in Indonesian Literature from New Order Reformation Era, dari Journal of International Women's Studies di bulan Mei 2022, ya, forthcoming, dan Literatur Sexualité en Indonésie, Les Enjeux de la Réforme in la Revue Clio, dari forthcoming juga, ya, ini. Beliau merupakan anggota tim penyusun peraturan rektor tentang pencegahan dan penanganan kasus kekerasan seksual di lingkungan UGM. Baik, Profesor Wening, kami persilakan.
Terima kasih, Mbak MC, ya. Good afternoon, everyone. I will speak in English. First of all, I would like to thank Monsieur Stéphane Dauvert and also Madame Philomène Robin for inviting me in this forum. And also UN Women for inviting me. I think this is the third time in different cases. Thank you very much, Mbak Dwi, atas undangannya. Okay, I will share the screen. I think I hope you will see my screen. So my presentation is entitled "Sexual Violence at Campus." I think when we talk about sexual violence at campus, we have similar pattern in the world, where the cases normally are done by professor to student, senior lecturer to junior lecturers, medical professor to resident doctors, professor to administrative, male student to female student, etc. And many of them mostly are not officially reported because of the power relation question. So we deal with the silent cases where the victims, here I talk about the case in my university, the victim did not, because now they speak up, they did not openly talk about their experiences being sexually abused, because there was no law specifically on the case of sexual violence in Indonesia or at campus. So at result, there were repeated cases, even by the same persons in the same universities, and the student felt not being protected. So how's the situation at campus, especially in terms of legal law or regulation? So previously in my university, we have already the law on state human resource management. Usually it is for dealing with the cases done by the staff or the lecturers. And there's also rector's regulations on ethics. There's also rector's regulation on violence in 2016. But the problem is it is difficult to be implemented. Why it is difficult to be implemented? Because the definition of sexual violence is not clear. The sanctions are not clear. And several faculties and other units inside campus finally ignore the regulation. So why the reason for ignoring this regulation? Because certain sexual violence conduct are considered common to be practiced in the society. And also there is preservation of the status quo, not to talk about it, for the reason of taboo. And also the cases are done by the important persons, imbalance power relation. Here we can find the imbalance power relation. And also the cases are considered wasting the energy of the faculty leaders because of the long process and also involving psychological burdens. So in 2019, Ibu Dwi has mentioned about the case of Agni. So it is the first time the struggle to create the regulation on sexual violence in my campus in Universitas Gajah Mada. So in 2019, there is a big case between two students, and it's becoming a national news, attracted media attention. And there was in the beginning the lack of awareness and commitments to solve the case, and finally provoked student demonstration, and the committee was created to solve the problem. But the ethical committee split the decision. The unclear and loose definition on sexual violence, because sexual violence could be stated only if there is an act of sexual penetration toward the victims. So there was bias of the team members when treating this case. So the case was sent finally to the police that created a trauma for the victim. And there was no psychological intervention to help the victims because of lack of human resource and system. And there was no system to protect the victim. So finally, part of the struggles is the rector gathered another committee to create the new law on sexual violence. So members of this committee, the representative of a Faculty of Cultural Sciences, I became the representative of this faculty. And there's also Faculty of Political Science, a Faculty of Law, a Faculty of Psychology, and Faculty of Engineering. So we use gender perspective in trying to create this law, as some of these key persons of this committee are gender lecturers in their faculties. So after long struggles of students, the committee, and also health promoting unit, so we have health promoting unit in Universitas Gajah Mada, so the Senate and the rector finally approved the law. So the regulation of sexual violence in campus was signed by the rector in March 2020, and it's become the first regulation in Indonesia regulating sexual violence. This is Peraturan Rektor number 1, 2020. So what we do after that? So we need socialization to the policy implementers. We need to create a discussion with rectorat, the deans, the head of study centers, and also the student leaders in order to motivate them to implement the law and also to socialize this regulation to the lower ranks in the faculties or in the university. So socialization first is about the law itself, and then so second one is socialization about gender mainstreaming at campus, which is not easy. Third one, using gender perspective in solving problems of sexual violence. The fourth is creating mechanism for the cases of sexual violence through one door. We call it ULT or Integrated Service Unit. And here I'm very proud of my students, Faculty of Cultural Sciences, Lembaga Eksekutif Mahasiswa, Student Organization, who ask gender perspective to be incorporated in the compulsory required courses. And this is in mata kuliah, in the course of Pancasila, organized by the Faculty of Philosophy. And it is approved by the Dean of the Faculty of Philosophy, and we still try also to follow up about this motivation. And after that, we do also training for trainers. Why? Because there must be a special unit established inside the faculties and this in the university to solve the problem of sexual violence. And we need also several mechanisms and treatments for the survivors and the victims of violence. We need to listen and follow up the reports, and also we need the psychological treatment directly after the report. And then the university and faculties must have several persons in charge for looking after the units. So after that is also campaign against sexual violence. I think a lot of faculties, they already started to do this. So what is the importance of this regulation? The importance of this regulation is make the faculty easier to process the cases, because the mechanism is then standardized in all of the faculties. And the first thing to do is to protect the victims, giving psychological counseling, protecting them from threats, etc. And then also we built also a database for the cases of sexual violence, and also monitoring and evaluation. And this regulation is already implemented since the beginning of this regulation. And this creates room for students victims of violence to speak up. And we do now, we already receive several cases, yeah, that we try to solve. And it becomes the regulation of the UGM, Peraturan Rektor No. 1, 2020, it becomes also one of the inspiration of the Ministry of Higher Education to create the regulation of Permendikbud Ristek No. 30, 2021, when in March 2020, I was invited by Dikti to share the regulation of UGM. So one of the aspects which is also promising is that in my faculty, I talk about my faculty, we have Suar Asa. This is the Faculty of Cultural Sciences, Sexual Violence Prevention and Treatment Unit. So the members, there is lecturers, students, and staff. I think some of the students are here in the forum. And first of all, I would like to congratulate Ministry of Education and Research for the regulation of Permendikbud Ristek No. 30/2021. This regulation will save a lot of people from sexual violence at campus. Thank you very much.
Terima kasih Profesor Wening Udasmoro atas paparannya. Kami ingin mengingatkan kepada rekan-rekan sekalian yang ingin menanggapi atau bertanya, bisa terlebih dahulu mengisi kolom chat. Narasumber kita berikutnya merupakan Associate Professor dari Fakultas Hukum Universitas Indonesia, Dr. Lidwina Inge Nurcahyo. Dr. Inge meraih gelar doktor dalam bidang antropologi dari Universitas Indonesia. Beliau mengajar di Fakultas Hukum di Universitas Indonesia, dan beliau juga berkontribusi dalam penyusunan buku saku Standar Operasional Penanganan Kasus Kekerasan Seksual di Lingkungan Kampus Universitas Indonesia. Dr. Inge, kami persilakan.
Baik, terima kasih. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I will share my slides for presentation. Actually, I want to share about the condition at our university, Universitas Indonesia, before this regulation has enacted, and for the future. Okay, so actually, for the sexual violence cases in some university in Indonesia, we know that from some research that as found by RDN MUIS, for example, in Surabaya, 2014, about 40% of 304 women, female students have experienced sexual violence in their campus. And based on Jaringan Muda Setara research, they found that at 1554 from 70 female students in Samarinda have they experienced sexual violence. And our journalists from Tirto, Vice, and Jakarta Post in 2019 found that about 179 members of the academic community from 79 universities in 29 cities in Indonesia have experienced sexual violence. And also based on the research that helped by the special team of the Ministry of Education in 2019 and 2020, about 75% of respondents from that research state that they know or experience sexual violence on campus. Okay, this is the concept of the sexual violence based on the Ministry of Education, Research and Technology Regulation number 30, year 2021. I will read it in bahasa. Setiap perbuatan merendahkan, menghina, melecehkan, dan atau menyerang tubuh, kemudian juga dan atau fungsi reproduksi seseorang karena ketimpangan relasi kuasa dan atau gender yang berakibat atau dapat berakibat penderitaan psikis dan atau fisik termasuk yang mengganggu kesehatan reproduksi seseorang dan hilang kesempatan melaksanakan pendidikan tinggi dengan aman dan optimal. Kemudian itu diatur dalam pasal 1 ayat 1, kemudian juga mencakup tindakan verbal, non-fisik, fisik, dan atau melalui teknologi informasi dan komunikasi. Oke. So based on this concept, give us another hope that we can make our campus as the safe place for students to have their activities and also for this for the lecture to do their job. I want to share you about the situation before the regulation. Actually, the process of fighting for an independent campus from sexual violence has been fought for a long time. Perhaps you still remember the case of an artist who did sexual violence to one of our students in 2011, and the case is still not. Have a solution until now because the police said that the evidence is not enough to proceed the case. And actually, sexual violence prevention and handling the formation of rules is constrained. We need the umbrella rules for sexual violence prevention in campus. But as Professor Wenning stated before, until now we don't have the national regulation, an act, or the government rules. But after this this Ministry of Education regulation enacted, we feel so glad because it can be the base of the internal rules in our university. The complaint mechanism, and still before this regulation has been enacted, the complaint mechanism still mixed with other reports related to case, to the maladministration case, to the plagiarism, corruption, etc. in our university. So it because it's mixed up, the reports has been get a slow response, and sometimes the treatment for the victims is not accommodating the needs of the victim. So often the treatment based on the authorities' policy. So sometimes it can actually harm the victim. And also the case in some cases, when the case are reported, immediately the case terminated by the authorities. So there is no guarantee of further proceed. The party who happened to handle the complaint did not understand the procedure for handling the complaint. So sometimes the identity or the case itself, yeah, the story of the case spreading to the public. So yeah, it can be harmed. It can be harm the victim again. And handling sexual violence in campus is not easy to get help from other stakeholders. For example, from the legal aid organization, because we have a budget issues. Okay, there are some best points in my opinion based from the Ministry of Education, Ministry of Education regulation. First, this regulation can aim to strengthen the capacity of the young people to be noble character as mandated by Pancasila, the Constitution, the Higher Education Act, and also National Education System Act. The concept of sexual violence have a wider scope, and there are already umbrella regulation translated to the level of for the rector regulation, deans, codes of ethics in each program or departments. And also we can build our SOP, our standard operational procedure, better for the faculties or for the research institutes or for student bodies or organizations. There also have been education for anti-sexual violence for the prevention efforts, highly appreciate for that. And also in this regulation, it state that in campus, there should be an anti-sexual violence community culture. Wow, it's very, very, it can create a great things for the students to do their activities without fear to be a victim of sexual violence. And also in this regulation, it rules about the protection, assistance, and administrative sanctions. And actually, it's very nice that in this regulation, they also have the obligation to carry out sanctions for the perpetrator to get counseling, but on their own burden, their own obligation. So and also the victim's recovery even includes spiritual recovery by involving religious leaders to provide spiritual guidance in addition to psychologists, doctors, counselors as regulated in Article 21. Based on this regulation, the prevention and handling of sexual violence is arranged to be carried out in one crisis center in campus. But we still have a cultural and structural challenge in our university. In our university, and I think it's also happened in other universities, strong power relations and bureaucratic structures in campus still there. Yeah, the examination process are so layered. The victims sometimes they should repeatedly have to tell about their grievances again and again. So we need a simple mechanism for the victim to give their evidence or to share their experience in one stop mechanism. The obligation to bring the evidence actually lies with the state, but not on the victim. But in the sexual violence cases, sometimes the society or the organization or the university put the blame on the victim. So yeah, we should still struggling with the presumption of innocence for the victim in the sexual violence cases. So we should not measuring the moral standard of the victim in the process of handling sexual violence, but looking for the comprehensive evidence through the victim's testimony and the results of the visum et repertum, visum et psychiatricum, and also visum et psychologicum that need to be included in the evidence. And also, we face the psychological examination of victims and perpetrators is not important, but the problem is there is no budget for that. So yeah, it should be carried out, not just a formality. The process of giving testimony is important if there is a breakthrough in presenting evidence. The issue of the time frame for reporting cases needs to be taken into account. Old cases do not mean they have expired. They should be still proceed by the one crisis center or by the faculty or by the university. Sexual violence is violence. It should be the perpetrators that feeling guilty, not the victims. So we should have the education for the students or for the lecturers, so they can educate. So they don't should feel ashamed if they have been a victim. They can go to the crisis center or so on. So we also have a strategy for this, how to implement the regulation. First, in some faculty, we already have the standard operational procedure for Faculty of Law, Faculty of Social and Political Studies, and Faculty of Cultural Studies in University of Indonesia. But the rector's draft regulation of anti-sexual violence at UI is still in process to enact it because of the government regulation number 75, 2020. Prevention provision of anti-sexual violence material for new students, new lecturers, new staff, senior lecturers, and senior staff. So in this education for anti-sexual violence, we need to bring the education program not only for the new students, for the fresh year students, but also for the lecturers, especially the senior lecturers, because sometimes the perpetrator is the senior lecturer based on the power relation. Campus need to put some information boards regarding a do and don't related to the prevention of sexual violence on campus, but without discriminating against women, new students, new recruits whose positions are vulnerable to acts or excessive use of power. Planning and implementation of anti-sexual violence education began to be implemented for new students, lecturers, and staff. Several faculties are in process of upgrading the SOP to the DIN regulation, but they hampered by the government regulation number 75, 2020. Also, as the strategy for this implementation of the regulation, the participation of elements in the academic community in handling sexual violence on campus, not only the professor, but also students. As you see right now, we also working together with Hope Helps. All of the board of Hope Helps is our students. We need to raise awareness in the academic civitas to start communicating with respect to each other. And also we need a one crisis center in campus whose management consists of elements of lecturers, staffs, and students, not only lecturers or senior lecturers. In our hospital, in our university hospital, RSUI, we have the crisis center, but only for medical service. We need the comprehensive treatment for the students, for the victims, based on the element of medical, psychology, and also legal aid treatment. There should be Also, I have a request for the Ministry of Education. There should be some additional points for universities or faculties or departments or programs that have regulation on anti-sexual violence. So if they have a facility or regulation, there should be a point for accreditation based on the facilities or regulation. Also, campus should develop a good complaint system and not mix with the plagiarism complaint system or others complaint system. So at national level, I think we also should have the rules, the national rules. I hope our act of sexual anti-sexual violence enacted in a short time, we hope, and coordination between service providers with government agencies and academics regarding first aid service, hotline service, shelter and safe house, availability of quality legal and non-legal assistance, training for the law enforcers continuously, not only when they are in the police academy or a judge training, but continuously even they are being a senior officer. So special appreciation for, I think it's good also to think about the special appreciation or rewards for law enforcers, judge who are dedicated to solving sexual violence cases. And we need the adaptation of our procedural law to adapt with the new regulation about sexual violence. Merci, thank you, terima kasih. Saya kembalikan pada moderator.
Terima kasih atas paparannya, Ibu Inga. Selanjutnya telah hadir di tengah kita perwakilan dari Hope Health Universitas Indonesia, Mbak Dewi Wulandari. Mbak Dewi ini adalah Direktur Lokal Hope Health UI yang akan berbagi mengenai pengalamannya dalam menerima laporan kasus, mendampingi korban, hingga mengadvokasi tentang kekerasan seksual di kampus. Mbak Wulan, kami persilakan.
Thank you Mbak Ziva and Prof. Neng and Mbak Inga for the previous presentation, and IV also UN Women Indonesia for inviting Hope Helps to talk about this. On this occasion, I will present my PowerPoint in Indonesia to make it easier for audience to understand the new data and regulation governing the prevention and handling sexual violence per Mendikbud. Wait a minute, let me share the screen. So thank you. Apa sih Hopups UI gitu kan? Mungkin dari teman-teman juga belum ada yang tahu atau dari luar UI. Hopups UI ini merupakan pengada layanan tanggap dan pencegahan untuk kasus kekerasan seksual di lingkup kampus yang melayani Civitas Akademika UI. Hal ini tuh berawal dari gerakan mahasiswa yang tahun 2013 sempat ramai antara pelaku kekerasan seksual, yaitu salah satu dosen di Fakultas Ilmu Budaya, dan korbannya merupakan mahasiswi di Fakultas Ilmu Budaya. Kami pun akhirnya bergerak untuk membuat sebuah gerakan yang sustainable, hingga akhirnya terciptalah nih Hopups UI. Kami juga bagian dari Hopups Network yang tersebar 15 local chapter-nya di seluruh Jawa Barat dan Bali. Nah, kami dari tahun 2019 sampai tahun 2021 aktif untuk mendokumentasikan segala bentuk laporan kekerasan seksual yang kami terima. Dan di tahun lalu, dalam ringkasan di tahun 2020, dalam ringkasan tahunan Hopups UI 2020, kami mencatat ada 47 kasus kekerasan seksual, yaitu dari periode 2019 sampai tahun 2020. Kemudian di tahun Kemudian 39 kasus itu adalah merupakan ruang lingkup Hopups UI, yang artinya adalah korban atau pelakunya merupakan Civitas Akademika UI. Kemudian jumlah laporan di ringkasan tahunan Hopups UI 2021 itu terdapat 31 kasus kekerasan seksual yang diterima. Periodenya itu diambil dari Mei 2020 sampai Juni 2021. Mungkin teman-teman sendiri juga berpikir kenapa kok kasusnya malah turun gitu dari tahun 2019 sampai tahun 2021. Tapi aku hanya ingin menyampaikan bahwa kekerasan seksual merupakan fenomena gunung es. Mungkin saja saat laporan yang sekarang, publik sudah aware tentang kekerasan seksual sehingga bisa menekan korban gitu saat melaporkan. Jadi penting banget untuk kita sebagai masyarakat menciptakan ruang yang aman sehingga korban dapat merasa aman dan nyaman untuk melaporkan kasus kekerasan seksual yang menimpanya. Selanjutnya dari data hasil temuan HOPAPS UI ini, kami pun merangkum ke dalam 8 bentuk data. Kalau teman-teman sendiri dan yang lain ingin melihat secara lebih komprehensif, bisa diakses di bit.ly / publikasi HOPAPS UI. Lanjut, dari data tersebut kami merangkum status pelakunya siapa aja nih. Yang pertama ada pacar korban, 7,4%, pihak asing 7,4%, teman korban sendiri 44,4%, mantan pacar korban 40,7%. Dari sini kami melihat bahwa stigmasi pelaku kekerasan seksual hanya orang jauh atau orang asing itu tidak nyata gitu. Nyatanya ini malah teman korban sendiri menjadi pelaku kekerasan seksual. Kemudian bentuk kekerasan seksual ini beragam dari perkosaan, percobaan perkosaan, perbudakan seksual, pelecehan seksual, dan karena aktivitas mahasiswa juga secara daring, sekarang KBGO pun meningkat sebanyak 36,7%. Mekanisme pelaporannya dan pihak yang melaporkan, teman korban atau pihak kampus yang mendapatkan laporan, kemudian korbannya sendiri yang berani untuk melaporkan kasus kekerasan seksualnya kepada HOPAPS. Ini gender pelaku. Gender pelaku itu walaupun ya masih didominasi oleh lelaki, yaitu 96,7% dan kemudian perempuan 3,3%. Hal ini juga menghapus stigma bahwa laki-laki tidak bisa jadi korban atau perempuan juga tidak bisa jadi pelaku karena semua orang regardless gendernya apapun bisa menjadi pelaku. Ini juga gender korban laki-laki sebanyak 3,3%, perempuan 96,7%. Ini tempat kejadian kekerasan seksual terjadi, kemudian berdasarkan wilayahnya. Nah, sebenarnya di UI sendiri, teman-teman dan yang lain, itu ada mekanisme internal kampus sebelum adanya Permendikbud ini, diatur di Peraturan Rektor UI nomor 28 tahun 2018 tentang penanganan SIP duga, terus di SKM UI nomor 8 tahun 2004, Peraturan Rektor nomor 14 tahun 2019, dan buku panduan teknis tentang kenyamanan dan keamanan kampus. Tapi seperti yang Bu Inge sampaikan tadi, laporannya itu dimasukkan ke dalam seluruh laporan pelanggaran kode etik yang ada. Laporan nyontek, plagiarisme, apapun bentuknya dalam satu laporan yang sama. Di mana kita tahu bahwa kekerasan seksual memerlukan approach yang berbeda dibanding pelanggaran-pelanggaran yang ada gitu. Kemudian ini juga bukan tentang kode etik administrasi atau mal administrasi, melainkan kejahatan terhadap manusia yang memerlukan juga pendekatan yang berbeda. Nah, ini dia teman-teman, permasalahan penanganan kekerasan seksual di lingkup kampus. Nah, kami juga berangkat dari survei BMFH UI pada tahun 2018, sebanyak 79% dari 177 responden ini nggak tahu nih, kemana kita harus ngelapor kalau misalnya terjadi kekerasan seksual. Walaupun tadi udah ada peraturannya, udah ada mekanismenya, mereka nggak tahu bagaimana cara melapornya, bagaimana cara proses pemberkasan dan lainnya gitu. Kemudian nomor 2 permasalahannya, di peraturan rektor sendiri nomor 28 tahun 2018 dan kemudian di TAP MWA nomor 8 tahun 2004, kekerasan seksual ini masih ditempatkan sebagai tindakan asusila dan pelecehan seksual. Tindakan asusila sendiri seperti yang kita tahu merupakan penempatan terminologi yang salah gitu kan. Bisa leading to victim blaming karena mungkin kekerasan itu terjadi dalam hubungan pacaran atau misalnya unsur-unsurnya tidak dikendaki oleh masyarakat dan menyebabkan korban juga menjadi korban lagi. Kemudian pelecehan seksual juga seperti yang kita tahu cuma salah satu bentuk dari 15 bentuk kekerasan seksual menurut Komnas Perempuan dan 9 bentuk dalam draft RUU PKS gitu. Jadi hanya penyempitan dan tidak diakomodasi bentuk-bentuk kekerasan seksual tadi di peraturan di tingkat UI itu sendiri. Lanjut, ini juga berkaitan dengan peraturan yang ada, proses mekanismenya itu nggak diatur bagaimana penjatuhan sanksi atau berapa lama sanksi harus diputuskan gitu. Kemudian di dalam peraturan ini, peraturan-peraturan yang tadi sudah saya sebutkan juga, hanya ada sanksi punitif gitu, penjatuhan sanksi bagi pelaku, tapi nggak ada perlindungan saksi korban, kemudian tidak ada perlindungan saksi, tidak ada perlindungan bagi korban, tidak ada proses pemulihan, tidak ada proses pendampingan, tidak ada kewajiban-kewajiban terusan gitu, atau ya hanya sekedar sanksi aja gitu, sanksi administrasi bagi si pelakunya ini. Nah, pasca Permendikbud, kita mendefinisikan ulang nih, tadi kan juga Prof. Wening sempat mention nama baik kampus. Dulu nama baik kampus dianggap sebagai kampus yang gak ada kekerasan seksual sama sekali. Jadinya kampus mungkin hendak menutupi kalau misalnya kekerasan seksual yang ada atau denial kalau misalnya kekerasan seksual itu terjadi di kampusnya. Padahal sekarang kita bisa meredefinisi bahwa nama baik kampus itu, yaitu baiknya itu, nama baik kampus itu adalah kampus yang harus diukur dari kemampuannya dalam melindungi sivitas akademika dari kekerasan seksual, memberikan akses keadilan bagi korban, serta melindungi saksi. Jadi kampus yang tidak denial terhadap bahwa terhadap kasus kekerasan seksual itu pernah terjadi di kampusnya, kemudian melindungi korban serta sivitas akademikanya dengan menggunakan peraturan perundang-undangan yang ada di tingkat kampus. Nah, ini juga pasca Permendikbud itu diatur, teman-teman, kalau dari Diane L. Rosenfeld, menurut teorinya, tool teori atau tiga meja kaki, bahwa kampus ini dalam penanganan kasus kekerasan seksual itu harus memenuhi, pertama, pencegahan, penanganan, dan resolusi. Di dalam Permendikbud ini sudah lengkap gitu, bahwa ada tiga dengan teori ini gitu. Nah, ini juga, tadi aku juga sempat bilang, tiga teori yang disampaikan Diane Rosenfeld tadi, ada bentuk pendampingan, ada bentuk perlindungan, pengenaan sanksi administrasi, serta pemulihan bagi korban itu sendiri. Nah, ini tadi juga sudah sempat di-mention sama Bu Inga, kalau misalnya kekerasan seksual, definisi tentang kekerasan seksual dalam Permendikbud ini diperluas gitu. Jadi, diakomodasi dari peraturan-peraturan yang belum ada. Ini ada kekerasan fisik, kekerasan non-fisik, kekerasan verbal, dan kekerasan yang menggunakan teknologi informasi dan komunikasi atau disebut dengan KBGO. Ini kemudian diatur juga mengenai tentang persetujuan, dan alur pelaporannya juga dijelaskan secara tegas, di mana ada penerimaan laporan, kemudian ada pemeriksaan, penyusunan kesimpulan dan rekomendasi, pemulihan, terus tindakan pencegahan keberulangan. Seperti yang tadi aku Bu Inge juga udah jelasin, bahwa birokrasi di tingkat kampus itu sangat berbelit-belit dengan adanya alur pelaporan yang jelas. Jadi kita tahu bagaimana kita memasukkan laporan kemana, ke siapa, dan siapa yang akan memeriksa laporan tersebut, dan berapa jangka waktu lamanya laporan itu akan diperiksa. Ya, sekian dari aku, kurang lebihnya mohon maaf. Terima kasih semuanya.
Terima kasih Mbak Wulan atas paparannya. Rekan-rekan, jika tadi kita sudah bersama-sama mendengarkan apa saja upaya pencegahan dan penanganan kekerasan seksual di kampus Indonesia, beserta tantangan yang dihadapi, selanjutnya kita akan mendengarkan praktik baik yang telah diupayakan untuk mencegah dan respon kekerasan seksual di beberapa perguruan tinggi di luar Indonesia. Nah, narasumber kita selanjutnya, Ms. Purnasen, Visiting Professor, Child and Women Abuse Studies Unit, London Metropolitan University, and formerly Executive Coordinator and Spokesperson on Addressing Sexual Harassment at UN Women. Ms. Purnasen has worked extensively in the UK and beyond on inequalities and the pursuit of human rights, including as Deputy Director of the Institute of Public Affairs at the London School of Economics and Political Science, where she also taught gender and development, as head of human rights for the Commonwealth Secretariat and as director for the Asia-Pacific Program at Amnesty International. Most recently, she worked at UN Women, initially as director of the policy division and laterally as the executive coordinator and spokesperson on addressing sexual harassment and other forms of discrimination. Ms. Purnasen, we are pleased to have you this afternoon. The screen is yours.
Thank you very much, Chair, and thank you for that generous introduction. I'm sorry I missed the earlier presentations. I would really have enjoyed and taken a lot from listening to the students and their experience, and I hope that everybody is taking their voices very seriously. It's really important. It's a point I'm going to come back to. What I'd like to do in the few minutes I have is just map out a couple of large issues and look at the big picture. And then there's three examples I'd like to look at in terms of how things might move ahead in universities, hopefully give you some material to work from. I'm very struck, and I wish I had the right language to access the last two presentations, but I'm very struck to see there is so much work done. You have a lot of data available. People have been working on this for clearly some time and with some dedication in Indonesia. And so I wish you a really good deliberation today. And I apologize right now in advance for not being able to stay for the whole of the discussion. But let me start by saying that this, well, let me also say, you know, my last time in Indonesia, which was far too long ago, was actually in a university. So I have a particular fondness for having this discussion with you today. I was a visiting professor with you at the Sharif Hidayatullah University some years ago. And so to come back to Indonesia to talk about campus issues is very gratifying for me. I think it's really important to recognize why university life and campus life is such an important place and time for young people. For those who have the ambition, the opportunity to progress to higher education and to embark on a new phase of their lives where new ideas, new skills, and networks can beckon is really important. And for many, this period can be marked by excitement, by possibility, but for many, these are stolen by experiences of sexual violence and sexual harassment. On this first slide, thank you for putting it up, I've just put together a couple of examples from different parts of the world on what we know about sexual abuse on campus. It's not a good use of my time to read it all or yours, but it's available there. And I'm very happy if you and women or one of the other organizers want to share these data and these slides, it's absolutely fine. But look how recent a lot of those data are. Look how prevalent these experiences are on campus in different parts of the world, from Australia to Bangladesh to Canada, India and New Zealand. And part of the reason why we have this data, and you will tell your own story for Indonesia, part of why we have this data is that students themselves have put in a huge amount of effort, taken risks, and been extremely courageous in putting these experiences on the table and naming what has happened to them. I think that credit needs to be given, but also it's a point I want to come back to in terms of what we do in terms of moving forward. So yes, thank you for the next slide. Here is an important point about why we talk about sexual violence in, why does it matter? It matters because being subjected to sexual violence, being subjected to sexual harassment is absolutely and completely contrary to the educational mission of any university. It impedes the learning of victims and survivors. It also instills fear in those who are not, I want to say yet, but who are not victimized, but who live their lives on campus and frame their study in the fear of violence and abuse. It is a huge impediment to learning. That's the top headline for all of us. And who should care? Who should be acting? I want to move us away from looking at the perpetrator and the victim survivor, but to looking at this, and I think it was Lidwina earlier who said, this is a bigger problem for us all. Everybody should be part of the project to end sexual abuse. And what I talk about here is collective responsibility and collective ownership. It's not about looking at a few bad people who have somehow gone rogue and are bad apples. The issues, you know, again, Lidwina talked about structural issues and you're talking about cultural issues. And I want to come back to say both of those matter. The last two speakers mentioned issues around reporting and procedures and clarity of what should be done. Yes, procedures, policies, practices absolutely have to be navigable, clear, many in number, so people have choices of what to do. But later on, I'm going to say why these are still a problem. But beyond them, the policies, the practices all sit within a context which makes it possible for the inequality of power in a university to be reflected in issues of sexual abuse. Who has power? Who is able to abuse somebody else? Who expects to get away with it? Who expects to be believed? Who expects to be treated credibly? Who expects to be protected? What should be done? I'm going to give a couple of examples in a moment And lastly, on this slide, what I want to do is think about the three different areas of work and focus on the third. Yes, there's a job to do in reducing sexual violence and sexual harassment, all forms of sexual abuse, absolutely essential. Mitigating is the same thing. Let's make it better than it was. But if you look at the Sustainable Development Goals, and if you look at the bigger global commitments, actually, all our governments, all our states have committed to the elimination of all violence against women by 2030. So I'd like us to think about moving from reducing to ending or eliminating. We're talking about nothing short of that bold and grand vision. Meaningful efforts to end violence and provide justice, a concept I think we need to bring in here, are not about quick fixes, but about thoughtful and holistic work that takes on the cultural and often little expressed notions that excuse perpetrators, deny victims credibility, and refuse to see the harm that rape culture, and it does need naming, rape culture brings to educational settings. Efforts have to be integrated, integrated, consistent, and system-wide. Now, I won't dwell on this slide very long, but I do want to say around sexual harassment, let's remember we're talking about staff and students on campus. Students have a particularly specific experience, but staff too are subjected to sexual harassment and sexual abuse. And this reflects what I was saying elsewhere. Somebody earlier was talking about consent. In sexual harassment, we talk about unwelcome sexual conduct. It's a slightly different concept and a slightly different formulation. Consent is something that can be given under conditions of inequality to something you do not want. Let me just unpick that very quickly. So if you are in a situation at work or on campus where somebody says to you, give me sexual servicing, and then you will get this, or then I will get you a promotion, or you'll get a good grade in your exam, and somebody agrees to some sort of sexual conduct, it doesn't mean they welcome it. But it does mean where they feel so powerless and where inequality is so sharp, they may have consented to something they did not want. So we've looked for a shift in our discussions around sexual harassment from consent to unwelcomeness as the central concept. Mindful of time, let me quickly move on to the three examples I want to draw your attention to. And I think it's the slide that it is the next one. Towelin Humphreys, Tamale, the next slide, and Callisto. Now, I can send the reference later, but there's an extremely helpful publication by Graham Towel and the next slide, please, by Graham Towel and Clarissa Humphreys, thank you, which runs through what it means to really take seriously the work of ending sexual violence on campus. Now, what these two people do, this is a UK example, is they talk about a number of different elements, which I will only just flag because of shortage of time. One is the essential nature of a comprehensive institution-wide approach. It won't do to have one faculty here, one department here, one set of relationships here doing something. It has to be across the whole institution. Yes, get the policy right, get the procedures right. In many places, whether it's workplace, campus, these are not right. And because they've been developed mostly top down by people who haven't experienced using the procedures, they often are not reflective of what those who go through them actually need, find useful, supportive, and helpful. Education awareness raising must be, again, in place and must be institution-wide. And there must be an effective and supportive way of dealing with disclosures. Somebody earlier spoke about the presumption of innocence being a problematic starting point. And I have to say to you, in institutions where I've been doing this work over many years, this idea from a criminal justice approach is that there must be a presumption of innocence in any allegations. What I would recommend is that you don't presume anything. Don't presume guilt, don't presume innocence. But just be open to the fact that any report that is made could be based in real experience and then have an open mind and procedures that will investigate without any presumptions. And lastly, Towle and Humphreys also talk about understanding what trauma looks like, understanding that sexual violence, sexual abuse, and sexual harassment are not simply about a parallel to a cut on the wrist or a broken thumb or, you know, an accident. They have substantive, often unclear, often hard to spot, and often long-term traumatic consequences. And these must be built into any systems and procedures that try to deal with sexual abuse. Secondly, I'd like to point you towards some work that was done in Uganda at Makerere University, chaired by Professor Sylvia Tamale, where they were hearing about and had many experiences of sexual abuse on campus. And they did a really thorough investigation, primarily based on listening to what students and staff were saying about their experiences. Mindful of time, so I'll speed up a little bit. Their experiences, where they looked at issues on campus, the arrangements, the power relationships between lecturers and students, senior lecturers and junior staff, and so on. And what they noted, and this is a quote from their press release, abuse of power by those holding academic and administrative authority is one of the major causes of sexual harassment in the oldest public university in Uganda. And they felt this was a matter of some shame and embarrassment that needed prioritizing to be addressed. The Tamale review and report, I would suggest you take a look at. There are things to learn from there. They set up a task force, they set up certain procedures, they changed some physical arrangements on campus, as well as the procedures and mechanisms that we will talk about. And lastly, let me mention Callisto. Callisto is a web-based reporting system. These, I hope, give you ideas of what would be adapted and useful for Indonesia. Callisto is an IT-based reporting system for sexual abuse on campus, which was founded on the premise that those who experience unwanted sexual conduct may be more willing to report if they know that others have spoken up as well. I think we all know this. If you're a lone voice, it's extremely hard and be very costly to talk about what's happened to you. But if you know that somebody else is speaking, somehow in many conditions, it gives courage and encouragement and support to others to speak up too. And I guess we've all seen this with Me Too, with what happened there, that more people spoke, which encouraged other people to speak. And so a whole wave, a whole movement was built up. And so what Callisto does is to try and identify repeat offenders and recognize that they are a problem. I won't give you the figures very much, but they have three different areas where they offer an online engagement. First of all, anybody who's experienced sexual abuse can go onto the Callisto website and explore their options as to what to do. And they set out what different people can do in different situations. So you have three different options there. First is you put in your alleged perpetrator's details. And what the system does is to detect repeat offenders. We know through all our work through many years all over the world that you don't have one person doing one sexual abuse once in their lifetime and they never do it again. People tend to either build up or repeat what they've done. And so they run a matching system. If a name comes up more than once, they will act on it. At this point, no individual is being spoken to. This is all online. Secondly, by putting a report into Callisto, you create a record. So you have a document of what happened when, in case later you decide to act upon it. You don't have to at the time, but you log it. And thirdly, you have options in terms of what resources you can access. So Callisto gives support to those who are bringing to attention their experiences of sexual abuse on campus. So I've skated through those three very quickly, but I hope they will give you some ideas and perhaps some resources to look at as you go on with your work in Indonesia. Let me very quickly on the next slide, point out some things that I think make a real difference when you do the work around cultural change beyond procedural and policy change. The next slide shows you six areas of work. it's really important at the top to have the right leadership and messaging. And you've got this regulation from government, you've got a strong steer there. But that's not enough. If those messages are seen as hollow and not followed through in practice, then they are meaningless. And in fact, they undermine confidence rather than build it. And one of the big issues in all our work in sexual violence and sexual harassment institutionally is a trust deficit. Victims and survivors do not trust the systems to act for them. Secondly, there are two phrases that are used a lot, but in my experience are not actually carried through in practice. One is zero tolerance, and the second is victim-centered approaches. What does that look like in practice beyond saying those nice words? Spend time on it, learn from victims and survivors, and make sure that this has actual meaning in practice. Most organizations want to do training, most universities want to do training, but 30 years of work on sexual harassment has shown that training has not been productive. Why not? Think about changing it. What does it look like? We have some work done when I was at UN Women, which might help you in that. And I spoke earlier about collective ownership. This is everybody's responsibility, everybody's project. It's not just he said, she said, as they put it down and dismiss it. And make sure that everybody knows what happens when cases come to light and what happens when investigations, when the procedures are activated. Excuse me. Because that also helps to build people's understanding and confidence. If people make reports and they never know what happens, or it takes too long, they don't know if anybody pays any consequences for their sexual abuse, why would they report? Why would they come to the system? Because they don't know what it's going to do. They don't know that anybody will be held accountable. They don't know that there will be adverse consequences for abusers. And they don't know what support they're going to get either. So both of those go together. The organizational transparency is absolutely key. The next slide is possibly a little small for your screen, but what I've tried to do here is to say, don't constantly put pressure on people to report. They have good reasons for not reporting. And here are just some of them, because it's very costly, very costly. As somebody earlier spoke, I think it might have been Wulans who spoke about, you know, you get blamed, you know, in a way, the language I use is that stigma and shame attaches to the person who's been abused rather than the person who is the abuser. So why would you do this knowing actually you're going to be blamed? You've already been abused. You're dealing with the trauma and you're going to do this and you're going to be told, oh, it's her. She's making it up. She's always talking about these things. And so she gets blamed, and also she's frightened of retaliation on a campus. Is she going to be kicked out of class? Is she going to be able to finish her course? Is she going to be downgraded in her assessments? Those potential adverse consequences are real inhibitors to reporting. So I think starting from the point of view of the survivor and the victim, you might go on to a different place and a different type of reporting. And that for me is a point just before the last slide that I want to end on in terms of content, which is the best work we can do to end sexual violence, sexual abuse, sexual harassment has to start from the experience of the survivor and the victim. It cannot start from management. It cannot start from reputational protection. It cannot start from the efficiency of a reporting system. And the disposal of cases. It has to start with listening to and treating as credible and as knowledgeable, excuse me, those who have experienced sexual violence and told you why the systems haven't worked for them and what would make a change. So putting victims and survivors at the core of any development is absolutely crucial. And you have to protect them when you do that because they are the least powerful people on campus. My last slide for you, as I run out of time, is to say congratulations to you all for moving to this stage, for having the regulations, for paying. I want to pay credit to Agni, your Agni in Indonesia, who was part of, you know, the pattern we see elsewhere of students speaking up and putting their heads on the block, letting their experiences be part of the process of change. And so now you have this regulation. I know you're waiting for law to be passed. But you're at a really important stage, and I want to wish you well for the next steps. I think it's crucial to understand that trust, the ending of sexual abuse, the ending of sexual violence and harassment are part of making a university effective at what it does, encouraging and enabling learning, entry into adulthood from a school age. And this is part of the fundamental mission of any university. Listen to and learn from students and victims and survivors. They have knowledge and wisdom that will make our work better. And I'm also slightly uncomfortable about the they, us, because survivors are everywhere. Those of us perhaps in this room have had our own experiences. We are not discrete, separate categories from the survivors and victims we talk about. Let me know if I can be of any use, and I wish you well on the next part of the journey. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Sen, for the insightful presentation. Saat ini kita akan melanjutkan dengan mendengarkan paparan dari pengajar di suatu universitas di Prancis dan juga ahli hukum di Komisi Eropa. Ms. Marie Mercabron adalah profesor afiliasi di Sciences Po Law School dan associate law professor tetap dalam hukum perdata dan hukum perburuhan dan ketenagakerjaan di CNAM, di mana beliau mengepalai program gender, hukum, dan diskriminasi di lembaga penelitian LIS CNRS. Beliau juga merupakan anggota Komite Ilmiah Presage Sciences Po, OFCE Research, and Academic Program on Gender Thinking. Pada tahun 2019, beliau diangkat sebagai ahli Prancis tentang kesetaraan gender untuk Komisi Eropa. Ms. Marie Mercabron, the screen is yours. You're still on mute.
Okay. Yeah, I couldn't mute. Well, thank you very much for inviting me. I do not have a PowerPoint, so I hope I will still be clear enough. So I'm gonna switch to. I think this initiative is extraordinary, and I wanna thank the organizers for inviting me to this event, which was also co-hosted by the Institut Français d'Indonésie, the French Embassy, and UN Women. So I feel very honored to be here. So yes, as you mentioned, I'm a law professor and I work on how France has to conform to equality law, especially sexual harassment. And sexual violence are a form of inequality and discrimination now with our signature of the Istanbul Convention. And I'm part of this gender program at Sciences Po, working both on curriculum on gender studies and research and promoting equality in the institution. So I'm gonna try to speak on how Sciences Po went about to try now to create a safer campus for women and persons in general. And I want to say that I really appreciated the contributions I've already heard that were extremely insightful. And I have already met Professor Sen, and I really think that her last intervention contribution was very important. So this is a work in progress in Sciences Po. Things always have to evolve. We have made, I think we're starting to make drastic changes, but we know that to fight against these forms of violence, it has to be a continuing process. And so every year, I think we will be evaluating what we have done. And this is also about prevention of risks of sexual violence. So basically, I totally agree with Perna Sen. It's a question of a collective responsibility on equality and justice. And for some people that have a hard time to understand it, sometimes I also say it's also a health risk for all of us concerned in the community of the university. So I have 3 points to make. The first one is, why did Sciences Po University have to act more closely on these questions more recently in 2021 and 2020? Also, how they did it, and a couple words on how I am personally implicated in future action. But I know that Sylvain Domé will explain more concretely the program he has with Sciences Po. So first, why did Sciences Po make this recently a priority? It had a hotline and some guidelines for victims, but the training was insufficient, and just generally, I want to say, and the prevention for all bodies concerned, administration, faculty, and students, was unfortunately insufficient. And what happened, especially, is there was a crisis, and this happens often in a school. There is a crisis that triggers the necessity for change. There was the resignation of the head of the board of directors of the school's foundation, not the director, not the dean, first, because of a personal affair of incest in his family. And this revelation had not been circulated by basically the dean of the school. So he resignated and started this big quest of the substitute dean to redress, and the foundation of the school to come back and fight against this culture of silence just in general, even though if this was a personal matter, and see if Sciences Po was creating more awareness and prevention on these issues and acting on the violence in the school. So just want to say, yes, rules are very important. As a lawyer, I want to say we have an EU directive, 2006/54, that I can send you. We have, since 2012, very specific rules on sexual harassment, for example, hostile environment harassment, and also the question of quid pro quo harassment in the penal code and in the labor code. That's important for our staff, and in the educational code. So all this is super important. There's been a directive guideline of 2015 in higher education, trying to give also advice. And lastly, NGOs, one that's called CLASH, that's very good, that works with students. So my second point, this was, why did we act? The second point is because there's a rule of law and because there was a crisis. Second point was, how did the school react to a crisis and create impetus for change? And then I will talk about the future. So, well, the school had to realize that we had to brainstorm and elaborate new policies. So there was a big committee that was spearheaded by a professor, a professor outside of the faculty body, and that started investigations with members of all of faculty, administration, and student body from February 22nd, 2021 on till April 29th, 2021. Where a report came out, and it tried to have a global and rigorous perspective both on sexism in the school and sexual violence and equality. So it's a scanning study that after it came out with the problems in the school, also came out with 61 recommendations to change the culture in Sciences Po towards respect, civility, and equality between people at the school in the three spheres, faculty, students, and staff. So what happened to the investigation? Well, the investigation where I was heard, for example, coming from the law school, arrived at a conclusion that there were four principal weaknesses to pinpoint. The limits of the hotline that already exist for victims, and a lack of support of victims through the whole procedure, not enough too much disparity between the Paris campus and all the other campuses. We have campuses in Menton, in Le Havre, in Dijon, in other places, and there were not enough support systems in the other campuses. Second point, the disciplinary procedures were insufficient. There was not enough link between the internal Sciences Po procedure and the judicial procedure. So how you accompany victims also when there is means for criminalization. And so there was a problem of formalizing the procedure of investigation, which was not clear enough, and publicizing that procedure for all concerned. Third weakness, identifying situations of increased risk of violence outside of classrooms. So welcoming events, integration weeks, sports events in schools, parties, internships, study abroad, but also volunteer or field work linked to research. All those situations created situations of isolation of potential victims to defend themselves and increased vulnerabilities to verbal or physical assaults, and especially with social networks to cyber harassment, and special vulnerabilities of doctoral students and teacher assistants with more precarious statuses, and a very lack of training of educators and professors on violence against women and other groups. Especially trainings that didn't take into account to emphasize what Professor Permasen said, a lack of training based on victims' experiences. And lastly, no formal link between promoting equality plan in the institution, so equality in recruitment of faculty, of recruitment of students, of staff, and the question of gender violence or harassment. So those had to be linked. So what were the recommendations? I'll try to go through a couple. So first, create more possibility to signal facts of violence through procedures that are they create more proximity with students. So in link with student organizations or student representatives or in all the campuses, create more people that are referring correspondents that can be contacted in case of violence at all levels. Externalize a hotline, not have it inside the institution to make it more objective and independent. Enforce more specific legal advice and information, both to victims, but also to witnesses and whistleblowers. Reinforce the material that's used to accompany victims. Systematically start an investigation when there is a signaling of violence, because sometimes it wasn't systematic. Inform better about the judicial process outside of the internal process and also the sanctioning process. Protect the victims, have a whole procedure to protect the victims during the procedure. Create mechanisms of preventions within student associations that they can use outside of what is in the general procedure. Also create a kit for prevention of violence during parties. Also create evaluations, create in the questionnaires of evaluation of professors and internships, questions on inappropriate behavior or discrimination or violence. Also help train thesis advisors, PhD advisors, and doctoral students on the issue of violence. develop better platforms on to fight against cyber harassment, and finally, all sorts of mechanisms to develop better equality rules for recruitment of assistant professors, professors, and even PhD students. So all this should be linked to the plan of action on equality for men and women at Sciences Po. And finally, it was very important for Sciences Po to explain that this was going to be at the center of the new plan on equality in Sciences Po between men and women. And that, I think, is an important message. So what lies for the future? Well, I'm sure that Sylvain Domet will explain more concretely how, through France Victime, Sciences Po is working. Now we have a new dean. His name is Mathias Vicherat, just named last week. And he will implement 61 of the recommendations. These are a lot of recommendations, and they will be applied at different, through different steps. Some will be short-term emergency, very urgent measures to be implemented, and some will be implemented later. Through Presage, our gender program, we are also promoting degrees in gender studies, because we think that all students should know more about gender equality. We think that's a way also to fight against violence, to understand what equality is. We're promoting the equality plan imposed to the law school in law through law. So we're helping with the training. We have proposed the creation of a chair, a professorial chair on sexual and sexist violence, to promote research on these questions and to help also for the training on inclusion generally. So also for categories of students and faculty bodies and administrative that might be linked to intersectional groups. So people with disabilities, women with disabilities, older women staff, or foreign students, because we think those are poor, might be more vulnerable groups that can be exposed to violence. And finally, I'm working and heading the clinic on access to justice. And we have a specific program this year where two students are actually gonna help Sciences Po with their internal procedures. First, they're going to review all the legal norms and best practices all over the world. So I'm happy to hear about other universities to understand both what they're doing in other universities, what the legal norms are in terms of education in France, more specifically, what universities in France have done better work on procedures, and to develop, of course, the best practices, especially within an intersectional lens. Second, we will develop workshops with students to create legal empowerment, to prevent violence. And there we will use techniques that we already use with street law in disadvantaged neighborhoods in France, which is the theory of oppression, how you act out situations of violence to understand them, even when you're not a victim. And finally, next year, we will help with the procedure to accompany with victims in Sciences Po, just to tell them what are the best procedures in terms of disciplinary and criminal action. And so that's about it. Thank you very much.
Thank you for the invaluable speech, Ms. Marka Brown. Selanjutnya, mari kita dengarkan salah satu perwakilan dari jaringan France Victime Sciences Po. France Victime adalah jaringan yang bersentuhan langsung dengan para korban. Mr. Sylvain Domet, the floor is yours.
Okay, hello everybody. Thank you to invite me. I'm very honored to be here. And I'm going to explain to you what is France Victime and how we are working. And we have a special partnership with Sciences Po, and the students and the professor can join us by phone or send us an email. And so we are doing, I don't have PowerPoint, but I'm gonna try to be clear as well. So France Victime is a national federation of the Victim Support Association. And France Victime goals are to promote and develop help and assistance to victims, mediation practices, and any other measure that can contribute to improve victim recognition, notably by implementing restorative justice. France Victime brings together a network of victim assistance associations whose missions include legal information, psychological support for victims of criminal offenses in France, and the assistance offered free of charge and in a confidential manner consists of information on the rights of victims and the means of asserting them by jurists, as well as a psychological support if necessary. The teams of these associations include clinical psychologists specifically trained in trauma and victimology, jurists specializing in criminal law, as well as for some of them, social workers, which allows comprehensive and multidisciplinary support. So jurists of the association specialize in victim law, but are not lawyers. They do not represent victims and do not have the role of advising and defending the interest of the victim, which remains the prerogatives of lawyers. For ethical reasons, associations do not refer to one practitioner over another. In 2021, we count 130 association members of France Victime. This association hold more than 850 support location to welcome victims on the entire national territory, metropolitan France and French overseas departments. The general principles of action, victim support association open to everyone without discrimination of any kind. Services are totally free. A confidentiality rule is attached to every interview with a victim. And victim support association respects the victim decision-making autonomy. Associations are composed of 1,500 professionals, both employed and volunteers. From the end of 2018, France Victime start to operate the European helpline 116006 for victim of crime. And it is a free of charge helpline. It is open 7 days a week and 9 to 19 outside regular helpline hours. Incoming calls will be redirected to a voicemail and allows all people who believe themselves to be victims of a crime or major incident, personal offenses, property damages, collective offenses, terrorist attack, natural disaster, or traffic accidents to be assisted by professional in real time while still respecting their anonymity. Expert listeners offer attention and support in order to give victims an efficient access to the closest one of the 130 association members of France Victime. In 2019, France Victime telephone platform handled around 90,000 calls. In 2020, around 25,000 calls. And this year, we can imagine around 30,000 calls. Attacks against persons are the most common offenses. Among them, international violence in the majority, with a significant proportion of domestic violence, more than 50%. And the second most common type of offenses concerns sexual violence, around 20%. During the interview, there are a strong demand for a listening accompanied by a need for legal assistance. Indeed, during their journey, the victims share with us the feeling that of having been heard a lot by police, courts, lawyers, etc., but little listened to. The legal aspect is often the gateway to the appeal. It is only careful listening that a need for psychological support is also discerned, but this need is not immediately expressed in most of cases. Are you still here? I can't hear you. Okay. Okay, so we have a very short time. So we can have a discussion now. I don't know if is it okay for us?
Okay. Thank you, Sylvain, for sharing. Berikutnya, kita akan memasuki sesi diskusi ya, berhubung waktunya sudah menunjukkan pukul 7. Diskusi kita akan dipandu oleh moderator Ibu Atmike Sigiro. Dr. Atmike Nova Sigiro adalah dosen di Postgraduate School on Diplomacy Universitas Paramadina. Selain mengajar, Ibu Atmike aktif dalam advokasi hak asasi manusia dan hak-hak perempuan selama lebih dari 20 tahun, baik di Indonesia, di kawasan ASEAN, juga dalam gerakan masyarakat sipil di komunitas internasional. Ibu Atmike juga memperoleh gelar doktor dalam bidang ilmu kesejahteraan sosial dari Fakultas Ilmu Sosial dan Ilmu Politik Universitas Indonesia, gelar master dalam bidang kebijakan sosial dan pembangunan dari LSI, dan gelar sarjana ilmu kesejahteraan sosial dari Universitas Indonesia. Mantan pemimpin redaksi jurnal perempuan ini adalah salah satu pendiri Lokataru Foundation, sebuah organisasi HAM di Jakarta. Kepada Ibu Atmike Sigiro, kami persilahkan.
Ya, terima kasih Ziva dan juga UN Women, Kedutaan Besar Prancis untuk Indonesia dan Timor Leste, serta TV Indonesia, dan para narasumber yang luar biasa, para guru saya ini, Mbak Wening, partner saya waktu di Jurnal Perempuan, lalu Mbak Inge juga, lalu dihadirin saya lihat para peserta, ada teman-teman kuliah saya, ada dosen saya dulu di kuliah. Jadi kita semua berada dikumpulkan di sini dalam hari yang berbahagia, ya, bukan karena persoalan kekerasan seksual sudah selesai, tetapi karena kita melihat adanya kemajuan dalam upaya-upaya penanganan atau upaya-upaya untuk melawan kekerasan seksual, khususnya di dunia pendidikan tinggi atau di kampus. Dan saya sudah mendapatkan beberapa pertanyaan dari chatroom maupun dari panitia. Karena waktu kita sangat sedikit, jadi saya sebelumnya meminta maaf kepada narasumber nanti dalam menjawab. Mohon dapat dijawab dalam tempo yang sesingkat-singkatnya, tetapi tetap dengan jawaban yang jelas gitu ya. Baik, kita mulai. Yang pertama saya ingin bertanya kepada Mbak Kuning dan Mbak Inge ya, sebagai dosen di perguruan tinggi, bagaimana kita bisa membangun budaya yang tidak mentoleransi kekerasan seksual, khususnya di dalam kehidupan kampus ya, kadang-kadang kita juga mengalami bullying jika kita mengkritik pelaku kekerasan seksual. Ada peer pressure ya, kita diledek kalau kita membicarakan mengenai kekerasan seksual, pelecehan, kita dianggap tidak macho misalnya. Kalau laki-laki itu kalau tidak catcalling dianggap tidak keren gitu ya, ngapain sih ngomongin begitu aja, kok nggak boleh gitu, catcalling aja nggak boleh. Nah, bagaimana Mbak Uning dan Mbak Inge sebagai dosen di kampus menghadapi atau sarannya untuk merespon budaya yang toleran terhadap kekerasan seksual di kampus semacam ini? Silakan dari Mbak Uning dulu.
Silakan. Oke, Mbak. Etika, I will just directly speak to English, so it can be easier for the our friends from France and also from England. So I think one thing that we need to to do, how to make the sexual violence it's not disappear. It's very difficult, yeah. But I think the law should be respected and applied. This is the only way to do it. And the second one is that we have to be brave to tell people around us that this kind of conduct, for instance, certain conducts are not appropriate to be done, especially in campus area, yeah, because we are all in the campus area. So I think this thing, a lot of people don't want to do it, to tell people that this conduct, we have to stop it. Not a lot of people are brave to do it. We have to start to say it when especially after the for instance, when I share the Permendikbud respect to the WhatsApp groups in universities, in my university, lot of comments, yeah, and this is a negative comments, and we have to really confront them, you know, not to just not telling anything about, or not to respond to their bad comments, for instance. So we have to be brave to step by step, yeah, give people awareness that the sexual violence should be stopped at campus, something like that, Mbak Adnika, I think.
Oke, terima kasih Mbak Wening. Gimana dengan Mbak Inge, pengalaman di Universitas Indonesia dalam menghadapi budaya toleran terhadap kekerasan seksual?
Baik, terima kasih moderator. Terima kasih teman kawan-kawan yang bertanya. Nah, kalau dari konteks UI, biasanya saya dapat contoh yang bagus dari para senior saya, almarhum Prof. Iromi dan juga dari Prof. Sulis saat ini. Jadi kalau di dalam WhatsApp grup dosen, ketika misalnya ada satu yang bercanda dengan mengirimkan gambar tidak senonoh atau kata-kata yang tidak senonoh, kami langsung kemudian nggak ada yang ketawa. Di rapat juga begitu. Bahkan terus kemudian kalau Prof. Sulis dan kalau saya baru belakangan, karena saya baru jadi senior nih gitu ya, setelah usia 50 tahun ke atas baru senior kan, sehingga kemudian saya bisa langsung negur gitu bahwa sorry ya, di tempat saya jangan bercanda kayak gitu. Jadi stylenya memang jadi mungkin oleh beberapa mahasiswa atau rekan dosen kami dibilang stylenya kenceng gitu. Jadi tapi dalam hal ini kalau saya merasa bahwa kalau tidak ditegur, dibiarkan saja, itu kemudian akan terbawa-bawa terus gitu. Dan faktanya kan memang kita ketika rapat dengan pejabat, seringkali kan kemudian para pejabat ini di beberapa instansi ya, gampang banget gitu untuk misalnya bercanda jorok, atau misalnya nyentuh tangan dan sebagainya. Saya akan bilang bahwa maaf, saya nggak biasa dengan gurauan yang seperti itu. Jadi memang starting dari diri kita. Nah, tetapi kalau untuk konteks kampus juga, selain kita starting dari diri kita dan teman-teman bersiap-siaplah gitu ya, untuk kemudian terus dibilang gitu aja marah gitu, tapi biarin aja, lama-lama mereka akan biasa. Biasanya nanti awal di tahap berikutnya mereka akan bilang jangan bercanda begitu sama dia, nanti dimarahin gitu, tapi lama-lama mereka akan biasa. Nah, yang berikutnya adalah kemudian juga mulai dari internal organisasi kemahasiswaan sih gitu. Saya salut dengan beberapa organisasi kemahasiswaan di UI, termasuk teman-teman BEM fakultas juga, yang kemudian juga cukup solid ya, cukup konsisten ketika misalnya membuat peraturan internal maupun ketika memilih pemimpin, sehingga kemudian salah satu kriteria mereka adalah memang tidak terlibat dalam kekerasan seksual. Ya, Wulan ya. Nah, tetapi memang kadang-kadang kecolongan juga sih gitu, seperti itu. memang tidak akan langsung bisa selesai dengan 1-2 hari. Kami berjuang itu dari mulai tahun 98 gitu. Bayangin aja betapa lamanya. Prof. Ning mungkin lebih lama lagi daripada saya. Tapi ya itu, kita terus aja gitu. Jadi selama istilahnya gimana Wulan, selama nafas masih di paru-paru, kita lawan terus. Terima kasih.
Ya, terima kasih. Jadi zero tolerance ya, biarpun kita dibilang cerewet, marah, gampang marah, tetap kita harus mengatakan itu. Nah, Indonesia katanya budaya apa percakapan mengenai kekerasan seksual itu masih dianggap tabu ya. Budaya toleran terhadap kekerasan seksual masih banyak terjadi. Bagaimana dengan pengalaman Ibu Mari di dalam pengalaman di Prancis gitu? Apakah dunia akademik di Prancis juga masih menghadapi sikap yang toleran terhadap kekerasan seksual seperti pelecehan, catcalling, bahkan kekerasan seksual dalam bentuk yang lebih ekstrim. Apakah ada pengalaman yang sama dengan Indonesia?
Yes, it absolutely still happens. It can be seen as just humor, as just not too serious. And there is, to me, a culture change, I think, that first comes in terms of generations. So what we're seeing is a lot of senior faculty that think that this is not microaggressions, that it's a question of being witty and making a good ambiance, creating a good ambiance. And I think the new generation, this is where things are changing, but it's coming, the impetus is coming from the new generations, the younger generations, that actually through these allies and bystanders, so both women, female students and male students, that realize that this is a hostile environment for all and that it is a barrier for against learning. And so it's not good for learning in the classroom and outside of the classroom, that they're in an unhealthy environment. That way of looking at more holistically has really helped. And so we've put a lot of posters out too that give examples of, you know, bad practices, bad comments. And so that's also a way outside of, you know, awareness raising to work with present generations, but also with past generations of faculty.
Terima kasih Ibu Mari. Ya, jadi kampanye yang terus-menerus di kampus ya, seperti poster itu juga bisa membangkitkan dan apa menumbuh kembangkan kesadaran zero tolerance terhadap kekerasan seksual. Nah, sekarang saya ingin beralih kepada Mbak Wulan dan Silvam ya, sebagai kelompok yang bergerak untuk mendampingi korban kekerasan seksual di dunia kampus. Seperti apa tantangan yang dihadapi gitu. Kalau dosen tadi berurusan dengan membuat regulasi, menangani bagaimana membangun struktur dan mekanisme yang ada di kampus, juga mengubah budaya. Kalau pendamping korban itu apa tantangannya?
Aku izin menjawab. Mungkin kalau untuk
ya, silakan Mbak. Okay.
Tantangan untuk pendamping korban yang pertama adalah masyarakat yang masih menormalisasi budaya kekerasan seksual itu sendiri gitu. Kayak, ah itu balik lagi ya, lucon doang, guyon doang, kenapa sih baperan atau apapun yang lainnya. Akhirnya itu dianggap normal dan dianggap bukan kekerasan seksual. Padahal tersebut merupakan kekerasan seksual. Tantangannya masyarakat yang masih menormalisasi, bahkan orang yang memproses untuk penanganan kasusnya juga masih menganggap sepele gitu bentuk kekerasan seksual. Yang tadi juga aku sudah sebutkan, di UI ini peraturannya masih dicampur adukan gitu antara kekerasan seksual, kemudian tindakan kode etik lainnya seperti plagiarisme dan sebagainya. Itu sih tantangan terbesar sebenarnya.
Terima kasih Mbak Wulan. Untuk Silvan, pertanyaan yang sama, apa tantangan yang dihadapi dalam mendampingi korban kekerasan seksual di dunia kampus?
Can you hear me? Yes. One of the biggest challenge is that people can complain at the, in, with the police. It's something very difficult sometimes in France, and it's very hard to women to be to go to the police station and to talk about what happened. It takes a lot of strength, and it needs a lot of courage to do something like that. And sometimes and very often, and that's why it's very important to our associations to give those people a place to be listened to, maybe sometime before going to the police station, and to give the words to the policeman, is to talk about what happened with someone, with listening what happened without judging anything, but just hearing the just hearing. This is what we are doing on the phone here at France Victime, and what we hear a lot is about what happened in the police station after. We are not talking about what happened in a sexual violence, but at the police station, they need to be believed by the person who is taking the complaint, and it's an enormous fight with the police in France.
Is there anything else, Silvan? Ada yang lain? Sudah? Oke. Okay. Oke, okay, terima kasih, Silvan. Dan sebelum kita mengakhiri diskusi ini, saya minta maaf sebesar-besarnya kepada seluruh audiens, karena kita sudah melampaui waktu yang direncanakan untuk kegiatan webinar ini. Tetapi dari diskusi kita, dari presentasi yang diberikan oleh para narasumber yang luar biasa, kita dapat mengambil pelajaran bahwa persoalan kekerasan seksual bukan cuma persoalan Indonesia, tetapi juga persoalan di negara lain. Bahwa kekerasan seksual di dunia kampus juga bukan hanya persoalan Indonesia, tetapi juga persoalan di negara lain, seperti di Prancis, di Inggris, dan tentu di banyak negara lain. Tetapi kita patut bersyukur dan tentu tetap memelihara semangat agar upaya-upaya penghapusan kekerasan seksual dan upaya untuk menciptakan suasana pendidikan atau dunia akademik, pendidikan tinggi yang aman dan bebas dari kekerasan seksual tetap terus kita lakukan. Dengan adanya peringatan dari tahun ke tahun, 16 hari aktivisme untuk penghapusan kekerasan terhadap perempuan, maka kita telah membangun satu proses belajar, ya, sharing of experience dan juga solidaritas dari para pejuang hak-hak perempuan, pejuang hak asasi manusia, khususnya untuk menghentikan kekerasan terhadap perempuan dan menghentikan kekerasan seksual. Oleh karena itu, saya sebagai moderator ingin mengutip, ya, ada satu idiom atau istilah gitu, it takes a village to raise a child, ya. It takes the whole campus member to create a campus that is free from sexual violence. Jadi kita semua adalah para pihak yang memiliki peran untuk menciptakan kampus, universitas, pendidikan tinggi yang bermartabat, yang memberikan kesempatan bagi siapa saja, perempuan, laki-laki, dan siapapun untuk dapat menikmati rasa aman dan rasa bebas dari kekerasan seksual di dalam dunia kampus. Untuk itu saya, Atnike, berterima kasih kepada para narasumber dan juga kepada hadirin yang telah memberikan pertanyaan maupun respon. Mohon maaf, sekali lagi waktunya terbatas, maka saya kembalikan kepada Mbak Ziva sebagai MC dari diskusi ini. Selamat sore, salam sehat. Let's orange the world.
Terima kasih, Ibu Atnike. Sangat menarik sebetulnya diskusinya untuk dilanjutkan, tapi sayang sekali waktu kita sudah habis. Nah, tapi sebelum mengakhiri webinar hari ini, mari kita simak kata penutup dari PLT Direktur Jenderal Pendidikan Tinggi Riset dan Teknologi, Profesor Nizam.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Semangat pagi, salam sehat, salam sejahtera untuk kita semua. Bonjour, good morning. Ibu Bapak sekalian, para peserta webinar yang berbahagia. Pertama, saya ucapkan terima kasih pada Alliance Française yang telah menyelenggarakan acara untuk mensosialisasikan upaya kita bersama untuk mencegah dan menangani kekerasan seksual di lingkungan perguruan tinggi. Izinkan saya berbagi layar tentang upaya kita untuk mencegah dan melindungi warga perguruan tinggi, warga kampus, dari kekerasan seksual yang fenomenanya seperti fenomena gunung es, yang kita kemas ke dalam program episode ke-14 dari Merdeka Belajar, yaitu Kampus Merdeka dari Kekerasan Seksual. Pertama, kita ingin memastikan bahwa perguruan tinggi kita, pendidikan tinggi kita merupakan tempat yang paling aman bagi seluruh warganya untuk mengembangkan diri, potensi, dan bakatnya. Sementara pada saat ini kita melihat darurat kekerasan seksual di lingkungan perguruan tinggi ini sangat mengkhawatirkan. Dari laporan Komnas Perempuan, 27% dari laporan kekerasan seksual yang dilaporkan ke Komnas Perempuan itu terjadi di lingkungan perguruan tinggi. Kemudian dari berita yang kita dapat dari TIRTA-ID, kompilasi TIRTA-ID, ini berdasarkan 174 testimoni terhadap 79 kampus di 29 kota, itu terjadi banyak kekerasan seksual, 89% perempuan, 4% laki-laki, dan sisanya tidak menyebut identitas. Ini menjadi korban kekerasan seksual. Kemudian selama kita mempersiapkan Permendikbudristek untuk mencegah kekerasan seksual ini, kita melakukan berbagai kajian. Salah satunya survei yang kita lakukan di tahun 2020 dengan responden secara acak dari para dosen seluruh Indonesia. Ini 77% dari dosen responden survei tersebut menyatakan bahwa pernah terjadi kekerasan seksual di kampusnya. Kemudian 63% dari kejadian tersebut tidak diketahui atau tidak melaporkannya kepada perguruan tinggi. Jadi ini sangat sedikit yang berani melaporkan. Jadi kalau ini kita gunakan sebagai dasar, maka banyak sekali kejadian kekerasan seksual di lingkungan perguruan tinggi yang tak terlaporkan. Kekerasan seksual ini memang paling sulit dibuktikan, tetapi dampaknya sangat besar dan berjangka panjang seumur hidup bagi penyintas. Di sisi yang lain, kita juga dari kajian yang kita lakukan, kita belum memiliki peraturan perundangan yang dapat menangani permasalahan kekerasan seksual di lingkungan perguruan tinggi. Selama 2 tahun terakhir ini, saya sebagai Dirjen Dikti dan sebagai PLT Dirjen Dikti Ristek, itu mendapat banyak laporan dan kajian dari teman-teman adik-adik mahasiswa di BEM, UKM, dan sebagainya tentang fenomena kekerasan seksual yang terjadi dan tidak tertangani di perguruan tinggi. Salah satu alasannya adalah ketiadaan payung hukum di perguruan tinggi, karena area yang abu-abu, yang gray area. Kalau kita lihat undang-undang yang ada, undang-undang perlindungan anak, ini hanya berlaku untuk anak di bawah 18 tahun. Undang-undang PKDRT itu juga hanya untuk kekerasan dalam rumah tangga, jadi untuk yang sudah berkeluarga. UU Tindak Pidana Perdagangan Orang ini hanya untuk perdagangan kekerasan seksual yang terkait dengan perdagangan manusia. Jadi kelompok yang ada di perguruan tinggi, yaitu yang usia di atas 18 tahun, tapi belum menikah, kemudian tidak tersangkut dengan sindikat perdagangan manusia, tidak tercover oleh peraturan perundangan yang ada. Sehingga tidak ada perlindungan hukum bagi mereka dari kacamata Undang-Undang KUHP. Kemudian juga keterbatasan dari KUHP. KUHP itu hanya menangani isu kekerasan seksual yang tidak bisa melindungi identitas dari korban. Kemudian kekerasan seksual yang diatur pun juga sangat terbatas. Belum ada KBGO misalnya online atau penggunaan kekerasan seksual digital. kemudian bentuk-bentuknya juga hanya pada perkosaan dan pencabulan. Sementara bentuk kekerasan seksual di perguruan tinggi sangat beragam, termasuk di dalamnya adalah KBGO, karena rentang usia dan penggunaan media sosial ini sangat dominan. Terlebih di masa pandemi ini, dengan perkuliahan daring, ini banyak kasus-kasus KBGO yang dilaporkan ke perguruan tinggi. Peraturan Menteri tentang Pencegahan dan Penanganan Kekerasan Seksual di lingkungan perguruan tinggi atau Permen PPKS, ini sebetulnya tujuannya empat hal. Pertama adalah untuk melindungi dan melindungi hak pemenuhan hak pendidikan untuk setiap warga negara Indonesia sesuai dengan undang-undang, amanah undang-undang. Kemudian menanggulangi kekerasan seksual dengan pendekatan institusional dan berkelanjutan. Kemudian yang ketiga, peningkatan pengetahuan tentang kekerasan seksual ini juga salah satu isu yang penting. Jadi banyak warga kampus yang tidak memahami atau pengetahuannya tentang kekerasan seksual itu sangat terbatas dan bias. Kemudian penguatan kolaborasi antara Kemendikbudristek dan perguruan tinggi. Jadi ini empat hal yang menjadi tujuan dari Permen PPKS ini. Sasaran dari Permen PPKS adalah untuk mencegah dan menangani setidaknya 11 bentuk kejadian kekerasan seksual, baik antara mahasiswa dengan dosen, mahasiswa dengan perangkat kependidikan, mahasiswa dengan mahasiswa dari perguruan tinggi lain, mahasiswa dengan dosen dari perguruan tinggi lain, kemudian juga mahasiswa dengan tenaga kependidikan, mahasiswa dengan atau dosen atau tenaga kependidikan dengan orang dewasa di luar kampus, mahasiswa dosen tenaga kependidikan dan anak, serta dosen dengan dosen, dosen dengan tenaga kependidikan, serta tenaga kependidikan dengan tenaga kependidikan. Jadi ini yang di-cover oleh PPKS. Esensinya yang kita lindungi adalah warga kampus, baik itu mahasiswa, dosen, maupun tenaga kependidikan. Kemudian area abu-abu yang selama ini menjadi tempat sembunyinya para predator seksual ini, itu kita hilangkan. Sehingga dalam Permen PPKS itu kita tegaskan bentuk-bentuk tindakan yang termasuk atau terkategorikan sebagai kekerasan seksual. Jadi cukup eksplisit di dalam mendefinisikan bentuk-bentuk kekerasan seksual ini yang sempat menjadi isu selama ini, kontroversi yang lahir, yang muncul karena memang kita tidak ingin ada area yang abu-abu, multitafsir. Justru kita ingin setegas mungkin agar tidak menjadi tempat sembunyi bagi mereka-mereka yang melakukan kekerasan seksual tetapi tidak diatur di dalam peraturan. Dan kategori yang kita gunakan berdasarkan pada kategori standar baik nasional berdasarkan Komnas Perempuan maupun internasional baik dari UNICEF maupun WHO. Bentuk kekerasan seksual pun mencakup tidak hanya fisik tetapi juga non fisik termasuk di dalamnya verbal serta penggunaan teknologi informasi dan komunikasi. Jadi termasuk juga penggunaan media sosial. Definisi kekerasan di dalam Kamus Besar Bahasa Indonesia itu adalah ini tiga hal. Keras, bersifat keras, perbuatan seorang atau kelompok orang menyebabkan cedera atau matinya orang lain, dan paksaan. Jadi ini kalau kita baca definisinya, sehingga di dalam Permen PPKS itu kekerasan seksual itu kita define sebagai perbuatan yang merendahkan, menghina, melecehkan, dan atau menyerang tubuh dan atau fungsi reproduksi seseorang karena ketimpangan relasi kuasa dan atau gender yang berakibat atau dapat berakibat pada penderitaan psikis, fisik, termasuk mengganggu kesehatan reproduksi seseorang dan hilang kesempatan melaksanakan pendidikan tinggi dengan aman dan optimal. Nah, di dalam Permen PPKS ini memang bentuk-bentuk tindakan dengan kekerasan seksual ini kita rincikan, serta konsekuensi sanksi administrasinya itu juga kita define supaya tadi tidak ada gray area. Ini pasal 5 ayat 2 itu memerinci berbagai bentuk kekerasan seksual mulai dari ucapan sampai perbuatan fisik. Di semua bentuk kekerasan seksual baik yang verbal, yang fisik maupun digital itu kita atur di sana. Bentuk sanksinya pun juga beragam dari yang ringan sampai yang berat. Tapi semua sanksi ini masih di dalam lingkup kewenangan Kementerian Pendidikan, Kebudayaan, Riset dan Teknologi. Artinya sanksinya bersifat administratif, mulai dari teguran, penyampaian permintaan maaf secara terbuka, hingga ke pemecatan atau pemberhentian mahasiswa atau dosen atau tendik yang terbukti melakukan kekerasan seksual pada skala berat. Kemudian bagi perguruan tinggi itu juga kita berikan kepastian agar ini diimplementasikan betul, sehingga tentu harus ada sanksi secara institusi. Ini untuk memastikan penanganan kekerasan seksual, pencegahan ini dilakukan secara institusional, jadi tidak hanya ad hoc. Kemudian juga bagi perguruan tinggi wajib untuk kalau ada kekerasan seksual yang dilaporkan itu wajib untuk melakukan tindak lanjut mulai dari pendampingan, perlindungan, pemulihan korban hingga pengenaan sanksi kepada pelaku. Jadi empat hal ini yang perlu kita lakukan. Lima sebenarnya dengan satu pelaporan. Jadi ini sangat penting. Ada kepastian tempat melapor, ada kepastian rasa aman ketika melapor, terlindungi ketika melapor. Jadi perlindungan ini yang sangat penting bagi terutama bagi penyintas, bagi korban. Kemudian Permen PPKS juga mengatur langkah-langkah mencegah untuk mengurangi dampak akibat dari kasus kekerasan seksual. Pencegahan ini sangat penting dan itu kita utamakan baik secara institusional melalui pendidikan, melalui pembelajaran, penguatan tata kelola, serta budaya komunitas mahasiswa, pendidik, dan tendik. Kemudian pada level individu juga pembatasan pertemuan individu, misalnya one-on-one meeting di luar jam kuliah, kemudian juga di mojok lah, itu harus dihindari, dicegah. Dan kalaupun harus terjadi pertemuan one-on-one, harus atas izin tertulis untuk menghindari hal-hal yang tidak kita inginkan. Kemudian yang juga harus dilakukan adalah membentuk satgas di tingkat perguruan tinggi yang akan menjadi pembantu rektor atau direktur dalam melaksanakan PPKS. Dan untuk satgas ini tentu kita harus pastikan satgas ini kredibel, jadi memiliki kompetensi yang memadai untuk bisa menangani, mencegah dan menangani kekerasan seksual. Ini sebagai tangannya rektor untuk mencegah dan menangani kekerasan seksual. Tugasnya untuk mengedukasi, kemudian menangani laporan, dan memantau, mengevaluasi tindak lanjut dari pencegahan maupun pelaporan tadi. Kemudian apabila ada ketidakadilan, baik bagi korban maupun bagi pelaku, maka bisa minta ke Kementerian Pendidikan, Kebudayaan, Riset dan Teknologi untuk melakukan pemeriksaan ulang. Jadi pada tingkat pusat kita juga memberikan backup seandainya ada ketidakadilan yang dirasakan baik oleh penyintas maupun oleh pelaku. Nah, nanti dari pemeriksaan ulang itu bisa penguatan atau bisa memberikan rekomendasi lain kepada pimpinan perguruan tinggi yang nanti bisa mengubah keputusan atau membatalkan keputusan pimpinan perguruan tinggi. Kemudian pimpinan perguruan tinggi juga harus memantau dan mengevaluasi secara berkala seluruh kegiatan pencegahan dan penanganan kekerasan seksual serta kinerja dari satgas di kampusnya masing-masing. Nah, laporan ini kita harapkan nanti bisa menjadi bahan bagi kita untuk melakukan pemantauan secara nasional, evaluasi dan perbaikan-perbaikan ke depan untuk memastikan bahwa kita bisa menghapus kekerasan seksual dari lingkungan perguruan tinggi. Kita menargetkan bahwa satgas PPKS ini bisa segera terbentuk, terutama di PTN. Harapan kita dalam 3 bulan ke depan, itu 30% PTN kita sudah akan memiliki satgas PPKS, dan pada akhir 2022, Oktober 2022, kita harapkan 100% PTN kita sudah memiliki PPKS, demikian pula dengan PTS-PTS, kita dorong untuk segera membentuk Satgas PPKS. Untuk PTS-PTS kecil bisa berkolaborasi, bisa membentuk Satgas bersama-sama, atau bisa dilakukan pada level LLDT. Jadi melalui LLDT, kita harapkan 30%, 60%, 100% sebagaimana di PTN. Terima kasih atas kesempatannya dan semoga melalui Permen Dikbudristek tentang PPKS ini kita bisa mewujudkan kampus yang sehat, aman, dan nyaman bagi seluruh warganya dan kekerasan seksual kita hapus dari dunia pendidikan tinggi. Terima kasih. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Shalom, Om Santi, 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 Om. Thank you very much.
Baik, tamu undangan terhormat dan rekan-rekan sekalian, kita telah sampai di penghujung acara. Mewakili panitia dan tim produksi, saya mengucapkan terima kasih telah mengikuti webinar melawan kekerasan berbasis gender di universitas. Bagi rekan-rekan yang ingin menonton kembali webinar hari ini, rekamannya tersedia di channel YouTube IV Indonesia. Jangan lupa, masih ada banyak rangkaian acara dalam rangka kampanye 16 hari anti kekerasan kami yang lainnya. Informasinya dapat dilihat melalui Twitter dan Facebook IV atau di @IV_Indonesia atau Institut Français d'Indonésie serta Twitter, Facebook, dan Instagram UN Women Indonesia di @UNWomenID. Saya Ziva, pamit undur diri. Sampai jumpa di lain kesempatan. Thank you for having me and have a pleasant evening.
Perjuangan untuk kesetaraan dan penghapusan kekerasan berbasis gender adalah masalah dunia dan juga merupakan prioritas bersama bagi Prancis dan Indonesia. Kekerasan terhadap wanita dan perempuan dapat ditemukan di semua negara dan di masyarakat. Hal ini dapat terjadi di rumah, sekolah, di jalan, tempat kerja, di internet, dan juga di tempat lainnya. Menurut hasil studi WHO, 1 dari 3 perempuan adalah korban kekerasan setidaknya sekali seumur hidupnya. Dimanapun di dunia, kekerasan berbasis gender seperti kekerasan fisik, kekerasan psikologis, juga perlakuan tidak adil terlalu sering diabaikan dan dibiarkan begitu saja. Karena hak-hak perempuan dan anak perempuan merupakan hak asasi manusia, inilah waktunya untuk kedua negara dan seluruh dunia turut mempromosikan kesetaraan dan martabat semua perempuan, laki-laki, dan anak-anak. Kementerian Eropa dan Luar Negeri Republik Prancis membuka jalan untuk perjuangan ini melalui kebijakan feminis luar negerinya. Prancis menyuarakan kesetaraan gender di forum internasional dan berharap agar tujuan ini dipertimbangkan dalam semua masalah, mulai dari pengurangan ketidaksetaraan hingga pembangunan berkelanjutan, perdamaian dan keamanan, pertahanan dan promosi hak-hak fundamental, serta masalah iklim dan ekonomi. Di Indonesia, sejak tahun 2016, Kedutaan Besar Prancis atau Institut Français d'Indonésie ikut serta dalam kampanye tahunan PBB yang bertemakan 16 Hari Aktivisme Melawan Kekerasan Berbasis Gender atau Orange Day yang memilih warna oranye sebagai warna dari masa depan yang lebih baik. Hari Internasional Penghapusan Kekerasan terhadap Perempuan dimulai pada tanggal 25 November dan diakhiri pada tanggal 10 Desember, Hari Hak Asasi Manusia. Selama 16 hari, Kedutaan Besar Prancis bekerja sama dengan UN Women Indonesia dan mitra Indonesia lainnya berkomitmen dalam memperjuangkan kesetaraan dengan mengadakan lokakarya, debat publik, dan kampanye kesadaran melalui media sosial. Prancis dan Indonesia bekerja bahu-membahu dalam upaya bersama untuk memastikan kesetaraan dan martabat bebas dari bahaya bagi semua wanita dimanapun di dunia untuk membangun masa depan yang lebih baik dan lebih cerah bagi generasi berikutnya.